Welcome, Dr. Hilal Ahmed.
Hi. Can you hear me? Hi. Can you hear me?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. Clearly.
Okay.
Okay. So now we can start. I'll just say a few words to begin with. This is being organized jointly by Delhi Comparatives and Tokyo University of Foreign Studies. Delhi Comparatives is a platform of comparatives who have been trained, who have been faculty members, who are faculty members of the Department of Modern Indian Languages and Literary Studies, where the concept of comparative Indian literature was formulated. And former students who are now doing their researches or are working, they are primarily our members along with faculty members. Since the beginning of the lockdown, comparatives started working on creating an archive, a digital archive of COVID-related cultural expressions, memes, cartoons, and along with that also articles, media reports, etc. Now we have entered the phase of researching on the material that we have found or we have gathered, which is a continuous process we are gathering now also. Tokyo University of Foreign Studies, from which Dr. Professor Masahiko Togawa is present here. Professor Togawa has taken our project for understanding South Asian Muslim identities. Under that project, he has sponsored a survey specifically about Muslim response to COVID-19 in India. This is part of a larger project where there are wars going on in Bangladesh and other countries also. So as part of that project, a dedicated group is working on the Muslim response to COVID-19 in India. This would be its first presentation in which we'll present primarily our understanding of the data we have collected. This presentation, this webinar is aimed at seeking feedback from scholars so that we can devise the departure points from which we can look at the data. So I'm really thankful to Professor Togawa and Dr. Hilal Ahmed who have joined us. I'd just like to add one thing that apart from this area, we are also working, Delhi Comparatives is also working to understand the COVID data through responses of women, Dalit, migrant laborers, transgenders, and other religious minorities like Sikhs and Buddhists and Jains. So this is part of a larger project. I welcome you all. Now, I'll introduce our chair of today's webinar, Dr. Hilal Ahmed. Dr. Hilal Ahmed is Associate Professor in the Center for Study of Developing Societies. It's well known as CSDS. New Delhi. Professor Dr. Ahmed has written on Muslim political discourse, the nature of Muslim political discourse. I would just like to add one thing. There are scholars who are working as part of their profession on various aspects of various social groups. What Dr. Ahmed has succeeded is that she has he has been able to change the way we look at the Muslim community in India while we want to look at, particularly given the minority status, assume a homogeneous character. Hilal Ahmed has succeeded in understanding and also showing us how the Muslim community itself is a diverse, has a diverse presence. So I'm again thank Dr. Hilal Ahmed for accepting our request. Now I'll pass the session to you. I'll introduce the three speakers we have. First speaker is Sadia Prince. She has worked on Kashmir and she will be presenting on the response. She will be presenting two reports. One, the general introduction to the project, talking about the general methodology, etc. And then she will move on to present on Kashmir. Then we have Zarqa Adam. She is also a research scholar. Sadia is a research scholar in our department. Zarqa Adam is a research scholar in our department. Zarqa has taken up Delhi and UP, the most contentious zone when it comes to understanding the mainstream Indian response, if you can call anything mainstream Indian. Zarqa will present on Delhi and the data collected from Delhi and Uttar Pradesh. And Utsa Sharmeen, she is working as a research fellow at the Mahanirvan Research Society, Kolkata. And she has worked on the response in West Bengal. After going through the initial reports, I can assure you this much, that you will find data which show how our general perceptions are mainstream perceptions are how much limited, and also how region to region the responses is vary, ideology to ideology, sect to sect. So with this, I hand over the session to Dr. Hilal Ahmed.
How much time we have for each speaker?
40 to 45 minutes. Yeah.
Okay. Without any delay, thank you very much, Dr. Chakravarti, for your kind words. What I am actually going to do as chair, basically the time management, but because I am very curious to know the ways in which you have conducted this research and the outcome. So after listening all these, I'll make a few points, but not in the beginning. So what I understood as a chair of this session is that we allow speakers to present their findings. And after that, will there be any discussion?
Yeah, I think it would be better if we have discussions after each presentation. You may decide on a time, say 10 minutes after each discussion.
So each segment is for 45 minutes?
Yeah.
Okay, including the presentation.
Is presentation, and then let us give 10 minutes for their.
Okay.
45 is maximum for presentation, and then let us give 10 minutes for comments and observations.
Fine.
Because this is a presentation based on which they will also go deeper into the data. So discussion is an important aspect.
Okay, so thank you very much. Without any delay, I would like now to invite Sadia Prince. And she would be presenting on Kashmir.
Thank you. I will share the screen, and first I will talk about the general, our general introduction and general methodology and all. And then I will go on to the Kashmir specific presentation. So I'm sharing a screen. Okay, is it visible? Okay. So, our project COVID-19 community in India. Just to give you a general introduction, COVID-19 pandemic has been successful in uncovering the issues of inequality and communalism in India, the state of minority communities where they are constantly discriminated against, has been exposed due to the events that emerged as a result of the spread of this virus. So this research intended to study the impact of COVID-19 on the Muslim community from various parts of the country and mapped the responses of Muslim community from the initial stages of the disease to the responses after the communalization of the pandemic. It also focused on the broader issues like the Citizenship Amendment Act that encompassed the pan-Indian responses of Muslim community, as well as those which are specific to the selected regions, which will be dealt separately in each presentation. Muslim community is not a homogeneous one. There are geographical, cultural, and ideological differences within the community as well. So varied responses and different opinions from different sections within the community, they also need to be taken into consideration. And you will see from our sample profile that we have tried to do that. These are some of the research questions that we tried to answer. How did the Muslim community respond to COVID-19 when its knowledge came in the public domain for the first time? The pandemic affects these
Sadia, your voice is not coming to us.
Research methodology to social media responses and
hello. Your screen is freezed and I'm not getting your voice.
Okay, am I audible now?
Yeah.
I would like to apologize. I'm actually on an unstable internet connection here.
I know. Yeah, we all know about that. Yeah, no issues. Yeah, you start from the second slide. Second slide.
Yeah.
And I request all of you to mute yourself so that we can have a smooth flow of internet connection.
So I was talking about the research methodology. The primary data, it was collected in two ways, through social media responses and through a survey.
Go back to the previous slide, okay. The question slide. Yeah, that's fine.
Okay. This research is aimed at looking into the following questions. How did the Muslim community respond to COVID-19 when its knowledge came in the public domain for the first time? What were the opinions of the varied sections within the community about the Tablighi Jamaat controversy? And how did the communalization of the pandemic affect these different sections? And what were the popular responses on social media that led to the communalization and those that emerged in response to it? And how did the response to COVID-19 change after the communalization? So these were some of the research questions that we were looking at. Research methodology. Primary data was collected in two ways, through social media responses and through a survey. Social media responses consisted of articles, memes, cartoons, videos, audios, and all these responses, they were archived over the course of the time. The survey, it was conducted in the form of online questionnaire and personal interviews. The questionnaire, it consisted of two sections. The first section included personal questions, and the second section had questions specifically about the general response to the pandemic and response to the communalization of the pandemic. Telephonic interviews were conducted on the basis of various professions like doctors, local, political, and religious leaders, whose viewpoints are crucial to understand the community's response. And again, efforts were made to collect the responses of people belonging to diverse age groups, economic backgrounds, castes, categories, sects, and ideologies. Methodology adopted for analysis. So the data that was collected from survey was analyzed and incomplete data was removed. A sample was taken from the complete data through the method of simple random sampling. The data from the selected sample was quantified and a general response trend was observed, which will be detailed in the different presentations, the general response trend of different areas. again to study the different perspectives, the data was binned into different categories. We have included response trend according to these different groups also, the important groups, because it's not possible to do everything. So we have included some of the responses that came on basis on different groups. So the social media data was analyzed in motion, as the aim was to see how the sentiment of people is changing through the course of events. So this is all for the general introduction of the presentation for all three of us. Now I will go to the Kashmir specific presentation. So COVID-19 and Muslim community in India, the responses specific to Kashmir. The data was collected to study the response of Kashmiri Muslim community to the communalization of the pandemic. Just a second. The background of this research, it lies in the congregation of the Tablighi Jamaat, a missionary organization that was held between 15th 17th March in Delhi's Nizamuddin Markaz, which emerged as the biggest hotspot in the country. And Muslims were accused of spreading the virus deliberately, and a hate campaign was launched against the community. The aim of this research is to understand how did the Kashmiri Muslims react to coronavirus before and after the communalization. Although we are dealing with the Tablighi Jamaat incident, we are not limiting ourselves to the communalization that emerged as response to this incident. We are studying the responses from the beginning of the spread of COVID-19, then how this response changed at the time of communalization, and what is the response post-communalization. So we are not only limiting ourselves to this incident. Now, when taken as a linguistic entity, Kashmir is a Muslim majority place with a few Kashmiri speaking pandits spread all over the country after their forceful migration. Kashmir does not, the terminology is important here, because Kashmir, it does not stand for the whole of Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir. It stands for the Valley of Kashmir, with a majority population of ethnic Kashmiris composed mostly of Sunni Muslims. Okay. I forgot to talk about the limitations in the general presentation. These were the limitations that all of us faced while conducting our survey. The responses collected through online platforms, they are limited to a privileged few, while others do not have access to phones or laptops or proper network connections. The personal as well as the government censorship also resulted in a kind of absence of different types of voices. During the personal interview, some of the people, they either answered vaguely or did not answer at all because they were scared of getting into trouble. So there were many difficulties faced in convincing people to talk about the Tablighi Jamaat incident, as they were scared that it can be dangerous. Even after being given the details of the project, many people refused to speak. According to many, the telephonic conversation, it can be misused to convict people of anti-national activities, so hence the refusal. Interviews were conducted through phones to follow social distancing measures, which led to lesser opportunity to talk to diverse number of people. These were the limitations that all of us faced. Now, some limitations that are specific to Kashmir are that because of the lack of proper internet services, things that did not open at all or took a lot of time to open. So, like, just to give you an idea, I take almost half an hour to send one email through 2G. So you can get an idea how difficult it was to access things. Again, there... was there is a heavy censorship by government in Kashmir, which resulted in a loss of many social media responses, most recent being the crackdown on journalists like Masrat Zehra and Gauhar Jilani for criticizing the government on social media, where UAPA charges were leveled against them. So if journalists are treated in this manner, you can imagine what common people feel about sharing any anti-establishment narrative. So a brief idea of the spread of COVID-19 in Kashmir. The Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir recorded its first case of COVID-19 on 9th March 2020 in Government Medical College, Jammu. However, Kashmir Valley recorded its first case of COVID-19 on 18th March in Srinagar. The first death was reported on 26th March, and the person was a member of Tablighi Jamaat who had attended the congregation at Delhi Nizamuddin Merkaz. So as of 2nd October, the UP has 76,163 cases, with 58,552 recoveries and 1,198 deaths. Just to give you a background of the region, when COVID-19 came, already been in a lockdown for about 8 months since 5th August 2019. Am I audible?
Yes, you are audible, Sadia.
Okay. When COVID-19 hit India, the Kashmir had already been in a lockdown for 8 months since the August 5th, 2019, when Articles 370 and 35A of the Indian Constitution were revoked. So these articles, they gave special status to the erstwhile state of Jammu and Kashmir, which included the separate constitution, separate flag, full autonomy over internal matters, and Kashmiris have separate laws pertaining to citizenship, fundamental rights, and ownership of property. Residents of mainland India could not purchase land and property in the state. On 5th August, these articles were revoked and Indian constitution was made applicable to Jammu and Kashmir. Moreover, the state was bifurcated into two union territories, the Union Territory of Jammu and Kashmir and Union Territory of Ladakh. So the emergence of Kashmir as a conflicted state, it is important to understand the response of the Kashmiri community to the COVID-19 pandemic. We are not going into the detailed history of the Kashmir. I just want to highlight two instances where a major decision on the fate of J&K was taken without consulting its inhabitants. So Kashmir, it was ruled by different communities over the course of history. It was ruled by Mughal Empire from 1586 to 1751, after which Afghans captured it. They were overthrown by Sikh ruler Ranjit Singh, and finally, after the first Anglo-Sikh war, Treaty of Amritsar was signed on 16th March 1846, and Raja Gulab Singh became the new ruler of princely state of Jammu and Kashmir. British never ruled the state directly. Instead, they sold it to Gulab Singh and maintained an indirect control over the state. So the sale of Kashmir to Gulab Singh for 75 lakh rupees was a transaction in which the people of Kashmir were not allowed to have a say of their own. The second instance that I want to highlight is after the partition, both India and Pakistan, they were keen on acquiring the princely state of Jammu and Kashmir. It was the decision of its ruler, Maharaja Hari Singh, at that time to choose between India and Pakistan, and he finally decided to join India on 26th October 1947. The opinions of Kashmiris were again neglected when the accession to India was made. There was no means to challenge the accession as the Indian army arrived the next day, that is 27th October 1947, and stayed. So the Kashmir dispute, it still remains unresolved, and people of Jammu and Kashmir have never been consulted in any way about what kind of solution they want for their land. Even the people's vote, popularly known as the plebiscite that was promised by both India and Pakistan, never happened in Kashmir. So how is Kashmir being a disputed region related to COVID-19? Arrival of COVID-19 at a time when the valley was undergoing a severe change, the abrogation of Article 370 and 35A, the division of state into the union territories, the change of the status from a state to a union territory, it shaped the responses of the people mostly against the Indian government. Also, with a network clampdown and strict curfews, Kashmiris were relegated to their homes, continuing the historical trend of never consulting them in any major decision of the state. And again, the communalization of the pandemic further aroused the feelings of disapproval in the minds of people. So I will come back to this point when I talk about the response of people about the comparison between the lockdown imposed after August 5 and the one imposed due to the COVID-19. Now, we have talked about the political history of Kashmir. I will give you a brief idea about the Muslims in Kashmir. So Islam was spread in Kashmir mainly through the missionaries and travelers who came from Persia and Central Asia. And therefore, Muslims eventually, they formed an important section of Kashmiri population by 13th century. The first known convert to Islam was the ruler Rinchen Shah. He ruled from 1320 to 1323 for 3 years, but he was replaced by Hindu ruler again by Hindu rulers. However, Muslim Sultanate was formally established by Shah Mir in 1339 AD, and during his reign, a lot of conversions happened. And eventually, the landmark event in history of Islam in Kashmir is arrival of Sayyid Ali Hamdani, the Sufi saint Sayyid Ali Hamdani, with his 700 disciples in 1393. He established many centers all around Kashmir to spread the religion. So, in this manner, Kashmir. Islam eventually became the majority religion in Kashmir. Shah Mir dynasty, it was replaced by Chaks, who were the Shia rulers. They immigrated from Gilgit region, which was a predominantly Shia region. So the influx of Shias also happened in Kashmir. So the Chaks, they lasted till 1587 when Mughals came to power in Kashmir. A brief idea about the social structure of Kashmir. The social structure of Kashmir, it changed after the advent of Islam, because most of the people, they converted to Islam, except Brahmins, most of the people, they converted to Islam. So all other castes, they merged into the fold of Islam. The traditional Varna order was replaced by an Islamic system, which you can say is still in place, because for example, the traditional Varna system of Hindus, Brahmins come before Kshatriyas, then Vaishyas. In the same manner, in Kashmir, the Sayyids are considered to be the upper caste, and then Sheikhs, then Mughal and Pathan. So this traditional Varna order, it was replaced by an Islamic system. However, the hierarchical nature was continued. Even after conversion, Hindu practices related to caste, family, marriage customs were retained, and they are still in a place in various areas in Kashmir. Now, if we come to our findings, social media data and findings, the distribution of social media data collected, as you can see, pictures, tweets, videos, memes, cartoons, articles, others, all of these were collected. So the responses, the pre-communalization narratives were mainly divided into two categories, religious and political. I have attached an example with each one to give an idea what I'm talking about. So religious responses, firstly, they ask people to have faith in Allah. Like the lockdown, it was compared to the Noah's Ark and how they were also stuck in the boat and they had faith in Allah and eventually they came out of this problem. And then the Islamic covering, that is niqab, the idea of the Islamic covering, it was compared with the niqab of with the mask and the covering that we are doing now. So blaming Saudi Arabia. Saudi Arabia, it emerges as an ideal in the Muslim psyche, where the people, they were not happy that now Saudi Arabia is not upholding the values of the times of the Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, that casinos and clubs are opening, and even they had a shoot for the Vogue magazine happened in Saudi Arabia. So people were not happy that they are not upholding the values of Islam. That is why this this kind of Allah's punishment has come upon all the people. Prayers to keep safe from coronavirus. A lot of prayers were circulated that when corona spreads, you can read these verses and then you will be safe from these diseases if you read these verses. And again, the prayers were saying that you should pray instead of demanding for the 4G services. Religious bodies, they advise people to stay at home and pray. Then sayings of Prophet Muhammad, peace be upon him, like one should not enter or leave an area where the disease has spread. Also other sayings like this one here, that whoever sits in his house, so that people are safe from him and he is safe from the people, his security is guaranteed by Allah. So these were all circulated. Now, if we come to the political responses, the condition of the whole world, it was compared to Kashmir, that now they are also facing what the Kashmiris face on the daily basis. Then 4G ban and the problems that emerged because of the 4G ban, how doctors were not able to download the guidelines for the treatment of the patients. Also memes about the lockdown or Hartal binary, that if you really want Kashmiris to stay indoors, just call it a Hartal. That Kashmiris are so used to go on a strike that if you want them to stay at home, just say it is a Hartal and they will happily stay at home. The worsening condition of the education system, where rest of the world, they are studying, but students in Kashmir, they are not able to study because of the lack of the internet facilities. Again, police brutality has almost become synonymous with Kashmir, where even the doctors going on to their duties were beaten up. And people who stepped out for a bit, they were also beaten up. So these also featured in the social media posts. Now, if we talk about the narratives at the time of communalization, so there was people were aware how the Muslims are targeted in if anything happens in India, and there was a general sense of sympathy with the Muslims, as people could identify with them. Then you must have seen this post in support of Tablighi Jamaat, narrating the whole chronological order of the incident. This was also circulated a lot on the social media platforms here. Again, a very famous cartoon that was carried out by a newspaper, and this is a criticism of that, how Islamophobia is at work in India. Tablighi Jamaat also faced criticism, as I have attached an excerpt from a newspaper article, but the criticism that was leveled against them, they were not calling them virus spreaders or anything. it was about the institution of Tablighi Jamaat itself, that it is a backward organization that has deliberately kept its members in shadows, and we should reform the whole structure of the whole structure of the organization itself, how it needs the reformation. If we come to post-communalization narratives, the whole idea of communalization, it was very short-lived in Kashmir, because then people, they were again preoccupied with problems that the Kashmir is facing. Again, how new laws like the domicile law were introduced during the time of the lockdown without thinking about that they are doing it in the time of a global pandemic. Then the crumbling healthcare system of Kashmir, where people don't have access to basic facilities, and because of the lockdown and everything, they are getting more and more deteriorated. Mental health issues have been at rise in Kashmir, where even the students who are not able to complete their studies, they are suffering from mental health issues, because as you can see from this example, that a degree of 2 years is taking 4 years to complete, and it still continues, hasn't completed yet. So you can imagine the kind of mental stress that the students are going through. Lack of proper facilities, that even in the times of a pandemic, Kashmiris, they are not provided proper facilities. Like, a picture is attached here of a quarantine center, and the condition is just deplorable here. Also, the influx of the migrant workers, that when the whole country was in lockdown, the migrant workers were not stopped from coming into Kashmir. When all over the country workers were going home, a lot of migrant workers, they were coming into Kashmir. So there was this general sense of panic and fear that this may lead to the rise in the number of the cases, that COVID-19, it is only for the Kashmiris and the migrants are coming here. Now, if we come on to the survey, this is the next few slides will detail the sample profile of our respondents. So data was collected through questionnaire and interviews. This data provides an overview of the nature of the sample. So language in which response was taken, a majority English, because the questionnaire was in English, hence we got a lot of responses in English only. Gender, age, the age varied from 15 to 78. Place of living, rural, semi-urban, urban. Educational qualification, it varied from 10 plus to research scholars. Profession, different professions were taken into account. Majority were students, but other professions were also taken into account. Community, general, RBA, that is reserved and backward areas, and ST community in Kashmir. Sects, Sunni, Shia, others. School of thought. So most people, they belong to Hanafi school of thought, or most of the people, they did not know or they did not answer this question. Religious inclination. So on a scale of 1 to 10, people were asked to rate themselves. So most people were above 5. Affiliation, people are asked if they are affiliated to various organizations. There were people from Jamaat Islami, Tablighi Jamaat, others, but majority of the population, they were not affiliated with any of the organization. Language is spoken at home. Majority of the people speak Kashmiri at home. Language is spoken at work. Majority of the people, they speak either Urdu or English. This is the distribution of the income of the people. So now if we go on to survey response trend, the initial reaction to the pandemic was characterized by various types of emotions. So people were scared, terrified, worried. So there was a general sense of fear among the people initially. Few people, they were shocked and confused about the nature of this disease. Others, they started to learn about it more and take precautions on a personal level. While the people who were not scared thought that it is not going to spread beyond China. When asked about how they rationalized the pandemic, majority of the people had a religious response as they believed it was Allah's punishment for the sins of the mankind. People who rationalized it scientifically thought of it as a disease, started researching about it and took necessary precautions. Some of the other rationalizations were, it is nature's revenge for destroying the planet. It is like other pandemics, for example, Spanish flu. It is an international conspiracy either by China or US. Some did not rationalize it in any way. The initial response of various local leaders, religious heads, Maulavis, also shows different sense. So they believed it was Allah's punishment, or it is a hoax created by the center to frighten the people of Kashmir, or it's a disease spread to kill the Kashmiri people. These political responses also came from these various leaders. And however, majority of them responded scientifically and advised people to take precautions and follow proper SOPs. So the options for the initial popular narratives about the virus and their response trend, most popular narrative was that this is Allah's punishment on people, that is the Chinese people who eat haram food, food that is forbidden in Quran. And considerable amount of people also believe that it is punishment on Chinese people for genocide of Chinese Uyghur people. Even in the social media circles, many videos were doing rounds where people were saying that they have dreamed of coronavirus coming and telling them that it is actually a revenge for what is happening to Uyghur people. So the least popular narrative, it was that it is that this is Allah's NRC to contradict the NRC and others. Some of the other narratives in this were that it is a bioweapon created by China to take over the world or to change the world order. Again, China features a lot in the initial narrative. It is China's attempt at diverting the attention of the world so that it can continue moving forward with the cyber warfare. It may be a virus planted by US in China. In the context of Kashmir, some narratives said that it is a conspiracy against Kashmiris by the ruling party. When asked about believing these narratives, there was a mixed response, and some people believed, some did not, and some said they are partially true. Other people were like, we don't know, we are not sure about it. So when asked about the differences between the current lockdown and the one imposed after 5th August 2019, responses were so varied that they cannot be categorized into groups. So here again I come back to the point of how COVID-19 is linked to Kashmir being a disputed region. So comparison between the two lockdowns itself gives the answer that how major opinions, they say that no difference in terms of economic and educational facilities, that even before this lockdown, we were suffering economically, businesses were suffering, people were losing their jobs, and again, educational facilities. The Kashmir has been in a lockdown, and the schools and colleges now, as I'm talking now, and schools and colleges have been shut for 13 months. They opened only for a few days in March, just before the lockdown was imposed, maybe 10 or 15 days. Apart from that, schools and colleges, they have been shut for 13 months now. Again, however, some people said there's a difference in the treatment of people. How the previous lockdown, it was characterized by a gross human rights violations against the people, while this lockdown, it is mostly for the on the basis of the precautions that we have to take. Again, a difference in the reasons behind the lockdown, that the earlier lockdown, it was a forced one, it was imposed forcibly on people, but now people are voluntarily sitting at home to save themselves. The whole world is experiencing what Kashmiris have to go through.
Adia, you have just 5 minutes to wrap up, because okay. It's already 42-43 minutes.
Okay. So whole world is experiencing what Kashmiris have to go through, and again, the difference between the availability of internet and calling facilities. Source of the Tablighi Jamaat incident, it was television for majority of the people. I'll just go through these. The response time, that majority of the people, they believed it was a genuine mistake on their part. Other responses were that they were stuck due to the unprecedented situation, like nationwide lockdown, and had been in touch with police and administration for a better chance to evacuate. Or both government and Jamaat people were responsible for it, but government was more. Or the poor people got held between the devil and the deep sea. Onus lies on the government, as they knew about the congregation and still let it happen. The reaction of the media and social media, it aroused the feelings of shock, anger, and disgust among the majority of the people, as they were propagating an anti-Muslim narrative. So people said that, the majority of the people said that the media was biased. As far as the reaction of other communities is concerned, majority of the people believe that all of them demonized Muslims. However, some said that it was a section of people who did so. When asked if the communalization affected them mentally, socially, or economically, majority of the people responded that they were affected mentally. A lot of people, majority of the people, they did not receive any criticism within the community for holding views different from the others. And now, lastly, when asked about how they rationalized the pandemic, now that it has taken so many lives, the responses, they can be categorized still as religious, scientific, and others. However, there's a decline in the religious responses. That people, they still have faith in Allah and say that we will go through this. But some people, they are waiting for a vaccine to come while taking proper precautions. Others are scared and worried. They just want it to end, as they are experiencing psychological effects of the lockdown. Now, I will just quickly show you the slides of the specific group responses. Okay, reaction during pandemic across age groups. So you can see the no fear category, it disappears in the age group of 51 to 78. Then belief in pre-communalization narratives about the pandemic across age groups. Again, majority of the elderly people, they believe that these are true. Opinion on the biased nature of media, the elderly people, all of them believe that it's biased. Reception of criticism for holding views different from others during pandemic. People who received criticism mostly belong to the age group of 15 to 30. The ones in 31 to 50, they were all doctors. Percentage of people choosing to remain silent is higher in women. Opinion of on Tablighi Jamaat, majority of the percentage in the men, they considered it to be a conspiracy by the central government. The difference is huge in the option three. Reception of criticism for holding views different from others. So females, they received criticism more often than males. Now, initial rationalization of the pandemic across residential area. So rural people, they rationalized it on the religious basis more often. Belief in pre-communalization narratives about the pandemic across residential area. Again, rural people, they did not believe it to be true. opinion on Tablighi Jamaat incident across residential areas. So a lot of rural people, they said they should not have gathered. The option two was they should not have gathered. So rural people were of the opinion that they should not have gathered, majority of them. Opinion on the biased nature of media or social media. So it's high in urban areas. Belief in pre-communalization narratives about the pandemic across educational qualifications. So people belonging to the senior secondary or below, less people consider them to be true. Effect of communalization of the pandemic across educational qualifications. So graduate and above, they were mentally affected. The percentage is high in graduate and above. Opinion on Tablighi Jamaat incident across categories. So other categories, they were divided, equally divided on if it was a genuine mistake or they should not have gathered. Effect of communalization of the pandemic across categories. So general category people, they are affected more than the others. Opinion on Tablighi Jamaat incident across sects. So majority of the people in the Shia sect believe that it was a genuine mistake. Opinion on the biased nature of media, social media during pandemic across sects. Percentage is higher in the Shia community. Effect of communalization of the pandemic across religious inclinations. So less religious people, they were affected more because of the communalization. Reception of criticism for holding views different from others across religious inclinations. So more religious people, they percentage of them receiving the criticism was higher. Initial rationalization of the pandemic across income groups. So you can say the moderate income group, they rationalized the pandemic. The percentage is higher for the religious rationalization. Belief in pre-communalization narratives about the pandemic across income groups. So the low income groups, they did not believe the pre-communalization narratives at all. Opinion on the biased nature of the media or social media during the pandemic across income groups. So high income groups, percentages high in these groups, they considered them to be biased. Effect of communalization on mental state during pandemic across income groups. You can see it is high in the high income group. The high income group, they believe that they got affected a lot. Now, to conclude, these are some of the key observations of this research, that among the narratives that people had heard about the coronavirus, the most popular one was that this is Allah's punishment to Chinese people who eat haram food, while least popular one was that this is Allah's NRC to contradict the CAA NRC of the center. So it shows that the anxiety over CAA NRC is not that prevalent in Kashmir as it is in the rest of India. So during the interviews, while I pointed it out to people, they came up with two rationalizations for this. They said that, firstly, they said that our ancestors have lived here before independence, so we are not worried about that. And others said that we have our own problems to deal with. Again, while the initial response to pandemic was largely political on the social media platforms, the interviews also reflected this.
So lastly, I was pointing out the key observations in this, the initial research. Firstly, among the narratives that people had heard about the coronavirus, the most popular one was that this is Allah's punishment to Chinese people who eat haram food, while the least popular one was that this is Allah's NRC to contradict the CAA NRC of the center. So it shows that the anxiety over CAA NRC is not that prevalent in Kashmir as it is in the rest of India. Yeah, secondly, while the initial response to the pandemic, it was largely political on the social media platforms, the interviews also reflected this when asked about the differences between the lockdown after August 5 and the current lockdown. So Also, the answers to Tablighi Jamaat case did show a great discord among its members, because the people who were from Tablighi Jamaat, they said that they should not have gathered, that they should have known better. The lack of trust on media or social media narratives is evident by the number of people who consider them as biased and propagating Islamophobia. And lastly, there was a decline in the number of religious responses to the pandemic from the initial response to the current response.
Is that?
Yeah, that's all. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you very much. Thank you very much. You had to take time because you were also presenting the general outline of the project. So I think it is sensible to give you more time. So that's why I thought that you should be given more time to elaborate the outline of the project and then the specific case of Kashmir. I have a few things to say, but I won't say it now. I invite questions for you or the comments, and then finally I'll make a few points which I have written while you were presenting on your findings. So, floor is open. Yeah. You can also, in Zoom, there is a possibility to raise your hand. If you click the participant button and raise your hand, it will be visible to me then. So, but now I think Satyanaji has raised his hand. So I would invite him to ask question or comment.
Satana didn't hear.
He raised his hand, I think.
Okay.
He has gone, but I don't see any raised hand in the list. Okay. Utsa want to ask a question in the chat box. Sadia, can you see that question?
Yeah.
Yeah. So why don't you just answer that question and then we'll follow the discussion. Now, let me read out the question. Yeah, the first is, why do you think so many migrants were going to Kashmir during COVID-19 while most from India were returning back home? So that was the question for Sadia. Sadia, your response.
Okay, it is a general trend here that when the summer season starts, the migrant workers, they start coming in to work here. So they work here from maybe March and April to September, October, and finally when the winter sets in, they start going back. So this time also the same trend continued and they were not stopped from coming into the state.
Okay. Any other question or comment?
Yeah, it seems there is no other question or comment.
So, okay, I have a few things to say. There are two kind of comments which I would like to make. One is a journal comment about the structure of the project. But I think it would be sensible if I say that point later, not now, because after hearing all the three presentations. So what I'm going to do is to respond to a few things to Sadia's work, Sadia's paper on Kashmir. First of all, I really appreciate the framing of the question. This is excellent way of frame a question and to conceptualize it and place in a larger context. So I really, really like the way you have provided a context in which something called COVID can be placed. So that's the first thing which I would like to argue or make clear to you. And that's why the lockdown of the abrogation of Article 370, etc., are important things to understand the nature of Kashmiri Muslims' response to the pandemic. Now, one clarificatory point, and which is very important, and we must remember this. You said that the constitution was introduced after the abrogation of 370. This is not correct. Constitution was always there, but in a limited way. There was a, remember that the Kashmiri constitution was part of the scheme of 370, and therefore it was inevitably part of the Indian constitution. So we cannot say that the, and remember, this is the dominant narrative that now one constitution, one nation thing. This is not true. Kashmir was integrally since 1957 was part of Indian Union, and constitution of India applicable through a different mode, like it is applicable in Northeast, say for instance, Nagaland. So therefore we have to be very clear when we are making technical points about the history. I really like the way, but I think you have to be, you have to provide some kind of engagement with Kashmiri history, because it appears to me that the history is coming like, you know, crude facts. So you have to engage with the Kashmiri history in a way with your specific question, which are related to Kashmir, which are related to pandemic. So this is about the background. Now your finding thing, again, these are very excellent findings about the divide you make between religious and political. I think you can also make a category called health, because the entire findings pre and post are not of the same kind. Obviously, there are religious responses. There are certainly political responses, but there are certainly health related responses which you have identified. But there is no category for the health related findings which you have in your excellent presentation. So therefore, you have to create one category called health-related responses. Now, you know, your post Tablighi Jamaat or post-communalization thing, before I go into that, I would like to make a quick point about, and this is, remember, when we collect data, data is not an answer. Rather, data is always a question. So I am interpreting your finding in terms of question. You are providing us a new set of questions. And therefore, my responses is not to the question the way you have collected data, rather how new questions are coming to us, not to you, but all of us. So if that is the case, then we have to be very clear about something called the formation of religiosity. Because most of the questions, like you have provided the political context, fine. But there is a religious context, because religion is a central component in your research. And if that is the case, then you have to understand and place the contemporary form of Islamic religiosity and place COVID into that. You find your findings are indicative of that. For example, technology. Remember that in last 10 years or more than 10 years, we have an acceptability in Islamic discourses for images, not merely still images, but also moving images. So therefore, people of Tablighi Jamaat themselves would like to be pictured, would like to circulate their pictures, would use audiovisual means to spread the message of Tablighi Jamaat. So therefore, that's, you know, that's not something new. It was already existing. Pandemic provided a new form to it. So for example, the practicing of Islam would certainly change. Now you have got various things online. So this online thing is not something related entirely to pandemic. There was some kind of a framework available for the religiosity. And when the pandemic came, that was amalgamated into that and produced new forms. And these forms are clearly coming out in your presentation. As I said, that you have to be very clear about that nature of religiosity. That's about your findings, pre-finding, etc. By the way, these are excellent findings. Now, coming back to the question of your sampling, which is an important point. I'm really, really surprised. You were very, very, as I said, that your framework is excellent. And this is something people rarely do, that is called identifying the limitation of a project. You were so intelligent that you have identified the limitation of the proposed research which you were going to do at that time. And these limitations are crucial. Yet, one point was missing in your limitation, and therefore, a question, it poses a serious question. That is, 83% people of your respondent speak Kashmiri at home. But the questionnaire was entirely in English. Now, when we say, see, language has got two meanings. One is language, meaning Kashmiri, English, etc. Language for the sake of language. But language is also a conceptual tool. When we say, for example, response to Tablighi Jamaat in English is very difficult. It is very different when we articulate in, say, Kashmiri or Urdu. So yes, therefore, that conceptual translation is needed. And I'm sure when you would be talking to people over telephone, etc., you must be doing that conceptual translation. But in a survey-like thing, you have to be very conscious of the linguistic turn it takes. So therefore, this is about that. Now, obviously, there are many things which I would like to say. Now, the final two points about religion and, you know, your distinction between religion and science. Now, this is a very old distinction. And if you read closely the way in which science is appropriated by religious discourses, especially in post-1960 world and especially in Indian Islam, you will find a different kind of meanings of that. So this distinction is, in my view, is not appropriate. Because now religion, especially the Islamic discourses, especially even Tablighi Jamaat, they would come and argue in order to seek legitimacy that we are more scientific than religious. So the dichotomy between religion and science has completely gone. Now science is actually a legitimizing object. So when you say, when you want people to believe you, you won't say that Allah is there, etc. You even not even invoke Quran. What would you do? You highlight the scientific factor which are contributing to the legitimacy to the point you are making. So it is also, if you closely read Tablighi Jamaat literature, you may find references to that. So this religion scientific dichotomy won't work. You have to think more closely about that.
Just let me respond to that. Now you have said it, something came back to my mind that when I was asking people about the responses of the local religious leaders, so a lot of people, they immediately, they were like, it was same as doctors. What doctors said, they also said the same thing. So again, the appropriation of the religion through the science, the combination of the scientific and the religion comes here. So I think I have to look into it more.
Yeah, the final point is, as I said, that, you know, many good things, many excellent things are in your presentation. And, you know, all these presentations are not answers. These are questions. And whatsoever I have said, it's not for you. It's all of us who are doing research on Muslim communities. So therefore, don't take it that I'm actually posing question for you. Actually, these are questions for all of us, in specifically for myself. Now, the final two points is about rural opinion or Tablighi Jamaat. This is an excellent point, I would argue, that it actually takes us to the reach of Tablighi Jamaat in Kashmir. And if we unpack this finding, we might look at the configuration of rural religiosity, and we can compare this with urban religiosity, even with this sample itself. Now, two quick points. One is about when you say less religious or more religious, it would be important for you to tell us more about how you are going to reach to this conclusion that a person is less religious or more religious. We have did a survey on that, and we measured that. And in fact, I'm part of Pew's survey, which is a global, in the entire India, 22 states, you know, survey in which we have measured, we have tried to capture the extent of religiosity among Muslims. So therefore, you have to say more on that. This final point is, which is again an excellent point, this is about the CAA NRC. As I said, that it underlines my argument that Muslim community is not homogeneous. It is entirely, you know, it is highly diversified. And therefore, when political attitudes and opinions comes, you may find a single issue is interpreted, you know, in a number of different ways. So therefore, CANRC would be completely interpreted differently in Kashmir. And this is again an excellent finding. So thank you very much for your, and if you want to say something, to please say, and then we'll move to the second presentation.
We should move on to the second presentation.
Oh, no, these are just comments. I have a lot of things to say about the framing of the project, which you presented in initially, but I really like the way in which you did your work and presented to us. So can we have 2 minutes break? So I can go and have my cup. Can we? So I welcome all of you again. And now I would like to invite Zarqua to make a presentation on one of the most contentious areas of our political life, Uttar Pradesh, and less contentious and problematic Delhi. Zarqua, floor is yours.
Yeah, Zarqa.
Thank you. What is the meaning of your name?
It means blue in Arabic. That's why it has a lot of associative meaning. So sky and something which is shiny or something like that. Yeah.
Yeah, it's very close to my mother's name, which is quite unusual. Zumrud.
Oh, this is more unusual than mine, I think.
Okay. Yeah.
Okay. So without wasting any time, I really want that important discussions should happen on this. So without wasting any time, I'll straight start with the presentation. So when COVID-19 came to the country, no one, including the Muslim community could imagine the intensity and the scale of this virus would be so large. So many thought that it will pass on like other viruses without affecting India, much just like Ebola, SARS, and others. But when COVID-19 came to India and started spreading its tentacle across the country, it has transformed into the latest manifestation of Islamophobia in the country, which has been in the making in the recent times. And things changed for the Muslim community with the Tablighi Jamaat incidents, also known as the Nizamuddin Markaz incidents, when this missionary organization of a particular sect of Devbandi school, Sunni sect of Devbandi school, conducted their yearly congregation in the early weeks of March in their Delhi Nizamuddin headquarter. And people from all over the world participated in that. So few reports till now have come that had tried to understand the role of social media and these platforms like Facebook and Twitter in peddling hatred against the Muslim. But till now, no major study has tried to understand the varied opinions within the Muslim community to the criminalization of the pandemic and how they responded to it and were affected by the whole situation. Because it would be wrong to assume that every Muslim reacted to COVID-19 or the criminalization of the COVID-19 in the same way, and the impact of the whole episode over the Muslim community was uniform. So therefore, this research not only tried to understand the popular social media responses, but also to understand the varied opinions within the Muslim community about the whole episode. So coming to the region of my focus, which is North India and often referred to as the cow belt, is known to be the most communal region in the country, with Uttar Pradesh known to be the communal tinderbox with the highest number of religious conflicts and incidents of communal violence. And Delhi, with its close proximity with Uttar Pradesh, just when India announced the nationwide lockdown, just a month before that, has witnessed its worst communal riots in decades. Coming to how Uttar Pradesh dealt with the whole episode of Tablighi Jamaat, around more than 5,000 members of Tablighi Jamaat were quarantined, other than their families and the people they might have come in contact with. But what is important for us is how the state dealt with it here. So the Uttar Pradesh Chief Minister Yogi Adityanath has maintained, not only maintained that this particular congregation was responsible for the increase in cases, not only in UP, but in the entire country, but he maintained on several occasions that it was a well-planned conspiracy against the country. So around 34 temporary jails were created in different districts of Uttar Pradesh to lodge the members, and where they were shifted after they completed their quarantine period. So though the criminal cases against the Tablighi Jamaat were filed in court across the country, Delhi government, since this episode took place in Delhi, was the first one to file an FIR against the authorities. Also, what is important to us here is that the state health ministry gave separate numbers for coronavirus cases in Tablighi Jamaat. Not only the state central government, but also the state governments. And this reflected across the television screens in the same manner. So as all these reports and episodes kept gathering the headline, the incident acquired a communal color, and with hashtags like Corona Jihad and many others, which not only blamed the Tablighi Jamaat, but the whole Muslim community for the spread of virus in the country. So the commercialization of the pandemic affected all over India, and this research intended to look into the effect into this Hindi-Urdu speaking Muslim of northern region, an area which is not only communally sensitive, but was also the epicenter of the whole episode. But before getting into the analysis, it's important to recognize the communalization in the region in order to understand the situation of Muslim community against the backdrop of COVID-19. So going backward to the history, and to understand this so-called Muslim problem in India, I think one has to not only turn towards north, but in order to understand its roots, one has to begin with the post-mutiny period. So the Hindu and Muslims of northern region actually challenged the British imperialism and fought together in the 1857 war. But after this united fight, what happened was, as several historians have also indicated, that the British policies actually reflected a sharp conflict, were aimed at bringing a sharp conflict between these two communities. And however, it is it will be wrong to assume that the British rule over the Muslim community was uniform, the impact of British rule. Muslims of northern region divided into different class, reacted differently depending on their class, group they belong to. So, but having said that, it was not just the elites who were affected by the British rule, but also the common masses of the region. For instance, Muslim artisans who were heavily affected by the introduction of the British goods also joined the rebellion. 1857, more often known as the First War of Independence. And what is very important, these conservative religious ulema scholar of North India joined the rebellion and were fiercely anti-British. And in fact, they led a fight. There was another uprising by them in the year 1871, in that they were killed in huge numbers. So North India, especially the Muslim minority province of Uttar Pradesh, has played a very crucial and decisive role on the question of two-nation theory and later in the partition of the country. It was within this province that the Muslim League was organized as an offshoot of Aligarh movement, and the Pakistan movement developed its root starting from here, and later it got more popular in Muslim majority provinces. But a fact which is often overshadowed is that this is also the region where the Muslim League faced strongest Muslim opposition, who stood against the two-nation theory that endorsed the idea of partition of the country. So the failure of, if you see, the failure of 1857 revolt actually led to two opposite reactions. One was the people, or these Wahhabi ulemas who have participated in the mutiny, actually set up a Darul Uloom in 1867 in Devban, which is a district in Uttar Pradesh. And these ulemas actually supported Indian National Congress and were more closer to the artisans and poor masses. And they also formed this political party, Jamaat-e-Ulema-e-Hind, in 1919 to represent their philosophy and also advocated the concept of composite Indian nationalism. So what is, but it is also to point out that this Sunni reformist movement that started was designed to revitalize the Islamic learning and to purge the Muslim from what they considered as un-Islamic traditions and customs. But despite their religious conservatism, they stood by Indian National Congress. And most important point here, that the Tablighi Jamaat, a non-political Deobandi missionary, is which has been in the controversy recently, is an offshoot of the Save Deobandi movement, and which was founded in the year 1926. On the other hand, the opposite reaction was the Sir Sayyid Ahmed Khan, who vowed loyalty to the British and led to the foundation of Mohammedan Anglo-Oriental College and to push the modern Western education, which the ulemas were against, modern Western education. Not surprisingly, not for all Muslim he advocated this education, much less for Muslim peasantry and artisans, but for the upper class, more of upper class. And it was these newly educated English Muslim elites, educated under the guidance of Sir Sayyid Ahmed Khan, by and large, who also came from very distinguished noble family, who were the leaders of separatist movement among Muslims. And just like Jamaat-e-Islamiya-Hind, there were many other parties representing different sections of Muslim community that furiously opposed the Muslim League's demand for Pakistan. And you can see the name of those few of those organizations, and they collaborated under the banner of All India Azad Muslim Conference to oppose the Muslim League's demand for Pakistan. A important point here that what was Sir Sayyid Ahmed Khan's argument was, which later also became the main argument for the Pakistan movement, he said that to this larger community would override the interest of the smaller community. But the smaller community, by that I think he was meaning the elites, since the to point out there is one notable political party, All India Mormon Conference. It was also known as the Jamaatul Ansar. It formed to articulate the interest of the weavers community, common Muslims, unlike the Muslim League. So the composition of All India Azad Muslim Conference was of lower and middle class more, unlike that of the Muslim League, which consisted of elites, more or less elites. And but it is very important to point this out here, that it is only recently that few historians like Peter Hardy, Anil Sale, or Asghar Ali Engineer, or Paul Brath have thrown light on the fact that Muslim separatism, according to them, was nothing but a political strategy of the privileged elites to protect their status. And a very important point has been missed from the mainstream narrative, that separatist movement was not basically religious in its orientation. If it would have been, then the religious ulemas would have been the leader of this movement. But you see, they stood by the Congress and not even once wavered in their commitment. Thus, we see it was not basically religion which was the basic motivating force of the separatist movement, as often so mistakenly believed. The basic motive was economic in nature and had class base. Or Muslim League and the two-nation theory found support in many communities, many sub-communities within the larger Muslim community, which was Ahmadiyya community. And also, ironically, the more tolerant sect among Muslims, which is Barelvi, also supported Muslim League's demand for Pakistan, arguing that befriending unbelievers was forbidden in Islam. On the other hand, you see that the ulemas stood with the Congress and against the partition. Therefore, these two movements, Deoband and the Aligarh movement, were often seen as two opposite sides of the Muslim reaction. And in the mainstream, what we hear more is of Aligarh movement and not of Deoband. However, unfortunately, despite this strong opposition, Muslim League had a huge victory in the provincial election of 1946 and won the majority of the Muslim seats. And the reason which it actually shocked many was, apart from the religious euphoria which was used by the Muslim League, was the electoral size and the limited franchise, which was defined by income, property, educational qualification, service in the army. And you cannot ignore the fact that the Muslim League being dominated by landlords and urban elites. And another important factor that was also that is often attributed to this result is the increase in the communal atmosphere, which led to the intense communal rioting between the period of 1923 to 1970 in Uttar Pradesh alone. So finally, ignoring the large population which actually stood against the partition, India was partitioned into two countries, and Pakistan came into existence. But only Muslims of the region, mainly belonging to the upper class and the professional class, migrated to Pakistan. And this is really important here. This, because this argument will play time and again in the communalization of the region, which and this narrative continues till date. This gave fuel to the argument that the Muslim of the region partitioned the country, chose to stay back in India, obviously neglecting the reasons for that. And therefore, who stayed have their loyalty questioned. This argument played a crucial role in the post-partition communalization, as I pointed out, and especially played again and again by the Hindutva right wing, which not only just ignore the fact that Muslims stood against the partition, a large amount of Muslims stood against the partition of the country, but also want to interestingly overshadow the fact that the two-nation theory, much before the Muslim League, was propagated by Hindu Mahasabha. So post-partition, what happened was the result of the partition on Muslim region was, it led to the social, political, and cultural marginalization, which led to serious identity crisis and the lasting impact on the post-colonial Muslim identity. And if you see, look at the communalization, it is only after the after India got independent, and it was only for the two decades we saw the reduction in the communal violence. And then from starting of 80s, we see another boiling issue of Babri Masjid and Ram Janmabhoomi. And not surprisingly, this is the most complicated, tension-provoking issue in the history of modern India, was situated in this region. And this issue was not only successful in raising the communal temperatures in the country or the rise of Hindutva ideology, but also changed the course of Indian politics. But ironically, but much expected, those who suffered the brunt in the post-partition communalization in the region are not the upper class elites who waited for the Muslim League and chose to stay back, but the middle class or the lower class who were out of the electorate, never voted for the creation of Pakistan and participated in the independence struggle of the country. So coming to the current times, so these narratives are at play, and currently the right-wing Hindutva government is in power since 2014 in the center, and since 2017 in the state of Uttar Pradesh as well. And Chief Minister of Uttar Pradesh, Yogi Adityanath, a right-wing politician, is quite famous for his controversial anti-Muslim rhetoric, such as Muslim population increased since 1947 because of the special rights, and Muslims did no favor by staying in India, and more. So setting this context, it was very important for us to look at, it is within this historical and historical as well as the current socio-political issues of the region, such communalization was made possible. So social media data. Since there are two forms of data that we have collected, one is the social media production and another is the survey-based data. So social media data that we have collected, coming to that, On 30 March, the coverage in ANI News suggested that the Muslim missionary events of the Tablighi Jamaat was a super spreader event, and after which these hashtags actually started. Social media outrage over a Tablighi Jamaat congregation was witnessed from articles to memes to social media posts, cartoons, Twitter hashtags, videos, hate speeches. And this outrage over a Tablighi Jamaat congregation took an Islamophobic turn, claiming that Muslims are intentionally doing that. This is not to conclude that it is after the Tablighi Jamaat congregation Islamophobic content which related Muslims with the COVID-19 came into existence. My findings regarding this is different from this popular belief, to which I'll come to later. But it is true that the social media outrage accelerated after the Tablighi Jamaat congregation to its highest level. And if you can see, since we are building the archive, the material that we have collected of this social media is the percentage divide is this. So highest percentage of the data that we have come across by far is consisting of cartoons, followed by memes, and then social media posts, and so on and so forth. So coming to these images, you see these cartoons actually encapsulate several messages within one single image. Flag invokes nationalist sentiments, Muslims potential threat, just like coronavirus. So Tablighi Jamaat, a single organization within a particular sect, became synonymous with Muslims. So in certain of these images, you see the Tablighi Jamaat. For example, in these images, you can see Tablighi Jamaat being written in both of them, but not in all of them. The other set of data that we have come across, a simple figure representing Muslim was enough, and few very explicitly called out to Muslim without any ambiguity. For example, this. So here, just a very stereotypical Muslim figure, and the coronavirus is in green color, and on the shoulders of which coronavirus takes the support on this Muslim figure, whereas Mr. Modi is trying to save the country with supposedly two threats to the nation. So these detailings of these images are very important, but right now we do not have a time to go into this. So I'll just concentrate on the broader themes under which these social media productions could be divided. But look at the another image. To roughly translate, it says even worse than coronavirus is Quran virus. And more than 20 crore people are actually suffering from this. So there's no ambiguity or there's no reference to Tablighi Jamaat in this. And very, very important, please look at the date of the second image. It is 10th February 2020. India didn't even had single official registered case. So there are memes which you can see on the screens calling out to Tablighi Jamaat. And China being the producer of the virus, Tablighi Jamaat being a distributor. And you can see the images of bombs, which is like for Tablighi Jamaat spreading jihad. One of the same thing, virus or the bombs. So inflaming the situation in India, the fake news plagued social media, and many reports came and about that Tablighi Jamaat members are demanding non-vegetarian food and are spitting on the doctors, etc., etc., some of them which officially were condemned. But how social media reacted to this, these reports are very is very important to us. So you can see in these images. There are wide number of controversies that took place regarding this. The last cartoon that you see is actually a cartoon from a reputed newspaper, Hindu cartoon, where a Muslim figure takes hostage, and the virus has taken hostage the entire world. And you can see the imagery of this. So all of this actually led to the call for social and economic, eventually led to the call of social and economic boycott of vendors and business owners and essential workers like domestic workers and cooks, as well as health and relief workers. And you can see in the first image, it says that if your relative purchases goods from these Muslims, then we should boycott those relatives as well. And in the second image is the vendors identifying with them with their religions, and because of their persistent mistreatment, they have placed the saffron flag to protect them from atrocities. Another is an ad for homemade cakes, and which says that it is made by gents and no Muslim staff was present for this. So, so the social segregation started, and this actually led to the refusal of treatments to Muslims in hospitals, and even the Muslim volunteers distributing relief materials were attacked, and therefore the religion became an added burden during this crisis. So, coming to the social media findings, therefore the most common themes include Muslims as coronavirus, virus as Muslim, both as a threat to the country. Fake claims like Tablighi Jamaat is intentionally spreading the virus, and this is visually supported by either an old or an out of context video. They're visually supported claims, not just somebody actually wrote it just like that. So another set of content actually called for the, as I pointed out, called for the boycott, social and economic boycott. But what is important for us here is that the majority of the content circulated was that is circulated in English and Hindi language. This problematizes the region and the language even further. So the majority of the content that we came across was originally circulated in these languages. And since we are building the archive, and our findings regarding to that has also been the same. And there is another report to cement this observation of ours. There is a Equality Lab report titled as Corona Jihad, which also finds that the majority of the content that is being circulated is in the English and Hindi language. And the same report also finds out that the digital footprints of this content is not just limited to India, but was active in US as well. So coming to the main finding, contrary to the popular wave, it is not after the Tablighi Jamaat controversy that the association between coronavirus and Muslims were made for the first time. It was in the starting of the month of March that the Shaheen Bagh was linked to. Shaheen Bagh was, this is the most inspirational protest of women who were leading, who were sitting against the CAA-NRC. So there was an aggressive push by the pro-CAA group to empty Shaheen Bagh using the COVID-19 argument, implying that the protesters are trying to spread the disease. So the fact, the origin of this association of coronavirus and Muslims actually lies in the protest of Citizenship Amendment Act, actually, that was going in India till in this was, which was continuing in India till India announced nationwide lockdown. So it is in the wake of this development that the first instance of the slur like jihadi virus came into existence, much before the Tablighi Jamaat episode. And look at this. Shaheen Bagh is bioterrorism. He demands strong action against his immediate effect. You can see the date. If you can look at the date, it's March 21. And same, another image on the right side is of March 19. And says and uses the hashtag Corona Jihad, just like the first image, and says that here in India, we have 100 of such terrorists who want to do biological terrorism against us. So this, by far, this has been the finding of the social media production. Now coming to the survey, now our focus will be on how did the Muslim community responded to all of this episode. It was very important to show you all of this because most of the questions that we are going to deal with came in response to these episodes. So contrary to the popular belief, as it has been pointed out time and again here also, that Indian Muslims do not constitute a homogeneous community, but are divided both vertically and horizontally. And on the one hand, they are divided on the basis of their culture, language, region, and the other hand on class, sex, etc. So therefore, this representation have been kept in mind. The objective while conducting the survey was to include as varied form of representation as it is possible. So, and the interviews were also conducted on the basis of professional representation within the Muslim community, including the local community leaders, religious leaders, doctors, whose viewpoints is also crucial to look at how the community responded to the situation. You can see the regional coverage of the survey. Uttar Pradesh is slightly higher than Delhi. And the language. To point out here, people responded in these languages. And the highest number of respondents replied in English, though the questionnaire was provided to them in English, Urdu, and Hindi. So it is not possible for me to show you right now all the samples. So I'll be showing you a few essential ones that is important for you to have an idea to what extent the different representation has been considered in the survey. So this is the gender chart. And another is the respondent's age varied from 16 to 80 years. So I'm going to move quickly through these slides to save time for later. So this is, yeah, professional representation is important. But yeah, so professional services, doctors, teachers, journalists, but equally important is the informal sector, housemaids, vegetable vendors, labor, mechanics, electricians, students, and researchers, homemaker, very important. And equally important for us is unemployed. So that this is the regional distribution of the sample, rural, urban, metropolitan, and semi-urban. And also you can see how diverse is the chart of the highest qualification, which starts from the research degree to no institutional education at all. Religion by birth, all respondents that has been considered, that has been interviewed for the survey, belong to Islam by birth, and few of them now consider themselves to be either agnostic or spiritual. Community, general, back OBC, and this is very important, class distribution of average monthly income of the household, which is very, very diverse, which starts from more than 3 lakh to someone who's earning less than 5,000 per month. Okay, this is very important for us right now, especially when we are trying to understand the response of the Muslim community for this communalization, of this communalization. So there is sect, there's Shia, there's Sunni, and the subsects, Devbandi and Barelvi. There is a reason this becomes very important for us. Because Shia political leaders like Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi, who is a cabinet leader in the current BJP regime, actually equated the meeting of Tablighi Jamaat. This is important because of their statement. So equated the meeting of Tablighi Jamaat to Tablighi crime. Similarly, another minister in Yogi Adityanath government, actually Mohsin Raza, who said that Tablighi Jamaat is an extremist organization. So these, all these leaders actually called for the nationwide ban of Tablighi Jamaat. But before I move forward, I think it's important to actually set a context for this. Actually, Shia, since they are a minority, felt that they are politically killed. They were politically killed by the Congress, since the Congress gives more representation to the majority sect of Sunni. So they formed alliance with BJP, many leaders. And many leaders believe that the leadership crisis in the Shia community will be solved with BJP in power. So they supported Mr. Modi in the past election, out of which, out of all the votes that the BJP has, Muslim votes that the BJP has got, around 22% were Shia, according to the survey conducted by CSDS. So you can see that the the ministers, there is only one Muslim minister in the central cabinet, which is Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi. He's a Shia. Another in the Yogi Adityanath state government, who is Mohsin Reza, who is again a Shia. So Shia are considered to be more close to power. But having said that, it is important to say that the influence of these leaders within the Shia public is still debatable. So Waseem Rizvi, there is another Shia leader who actually went even further talking about this. And he said that the Tablighi Jamaat has been a planned societal attack on India. They have planned this attack. And he even gave numbers to this Tablighi Jamaat. And he said they plan to kill around 1 lakh members, and it was a conspiracy against Mr. Modi. And also suggested the involvement of the Islamist speaker Zakir Nayar in this conspiracy. But not to forget that Waseem Rizvi is expelled from his community in the last September over one of his usual controversial remarks. Okay, so and now coming to Devbandi and Bareilvi. It is important to the Devbandi and Bareilvi becomes important to us since Tablighi Jamaat is a Devbandi organization. And Dargah Ala Hazrat, which is of a Bareilvi sect, it runs a non-governmental organization. So that the trust, it has a trust, Ala Hazrat Trust. Its president actually also demanded the ban on the Tablighi Jamaat. So let's come to the next slide now. So the distribution of this respondent in the degree was more skewed towards highly religious. Around 78.9% of the respondents actually considered them to be more religious. To point out here, this is the criteria. We have asked them to tell us how much religious do they consider themselves to be, and that is the result of that. Coming to the general response trend of the survey. In this presentation, I should make this, presentation, I'll be more concentrating on showing you the data rather than theorizing these responses. So they were initially, and by that initial, I mean the before Kamalization response to COVID-19, the Muslim community. So the Muslim So the response on the part of the Muslim community were not just the ones which came from me. Am I audible? It's actually Azan at my place.
Yes, you should actually continue. It's a perfect background. And okay. It should not disturb all of us because this is part of something which we are discussing.
Okay. So
you don't actually get diverted from it. You just focus. You are presenting very well. You just continue like the way you were doing.
Okay. So by initial, I mean the before Kamalization response, but on part of the Muslim community, the response was not just which came as a Muslim, which is very important, but also as an ordinary citizen who reacted in terms of many conspiracy theories that was going around, such as China conspiracy, or it is motivated by the trade war between China and America, and a hoax created by medical companies, etc. And you can see the highest is still a scientific explanation. And a very important point that is made by Hilal sir regarding the dichotomy that of scientific and religious that we have created. I'll come back to that later because we did witness in our response in one of my findings, and I did mention it at the later stage. But for now, we can see that the 40% actually rationalize it completely scientifically. And then there is international conspiracy, followed there's national conspiracy, and God's punishment is around 20%. And we have also, there was also a response of both scientific and religious. So we asked them what were the opinions of the religious leaders and clerics about the pandemic. But it is, I think it would be wrong to completely put the burden on the religious leaders and clerics about what were their views. Then we will be assuming that the influence of these religious leaders or clerics is same, uniform within the Muslim community. Though their influence also differs to a large degree. But the reason I meant this slide is important for us because in this Tablighi Jamaat, the communalization, religious leaders becomes important. And to tell you, there is one interesting respondent, a young imam actually told us that initially he gave a precautionary advice about taking precautions, and he was being mocked by the members, by the people. So he said that people thought that my iman is weak, and that's why I'm afraid of this disease. And he was initially I was condemned, and he says, see, now everybody is saying the same thing. And he say, and very importantly, the dichotomy of religious and scientific, he says that my religion doesn't say anything which is other than science, because, and he straight away gives the reference of the hadith where he says that see, the Prophet Muhammad has said this, that this thing happens, and he doesn't appear to have shown up shocking element about this pandemic. He said that has happened time in the Khalifa's time, in the Prophet times, and that's how it should be done. And then he also mentions a point, do you think my religion says anything different than science? So most of them initially did advised to take precautions, but there is also a section around 5% in the general trend which also said that this believed that this disease did not exist or wouldn't affect Muslims. Very important, these are initial popular narratives about the coronavirus within the community. So the highest number, so while the most popular narrative was looking at is as Allah's punishment for their increased sins and rising dissociation with what is prescribed in religion, on the other hand, the least popular narrative in this region was that it is a punishment for locking down Kashmir for almost a year by the central government. The narrative that initially looked at the pandemic either as a conspiracy or to remove protesting side against NRC across the nation were also present, like CA, NRC. It was also very popular in this region, since the anxiety related to CA, NRC is in comparison to other is much more in this region. Another regionally inspired narrative that we did not give them an option about, what we got the response when we mentioned them others, in others, one of the response was, though it was not a very popular one, that it is a punishment for Babri Masjid's judgment. So coming to the next slide now. So when we asked people that, what do you think about these popular narrative? A significant percentage actually tried to rationalize the narrative and gave the analytical answer, rather than telling us what do they think of the narrative. They give rational analytical answers, and not to assume that these people were the highly educated, though a large population was also urban metropolitan with the age group of 16 and 13, but it also had a rural population. Interestingly, rural population also, which I'll point out in the specific slides, also reacted in terms of rational and analytical explanation in terms of these popular narratives. And the people who said this as partially true actually believed in the religious narratives and did not believe in the political conspiracy theories. Everyone had heard about the Tablighi Jamaat case. though the opinions, I think it will be better to discuss the opinions of Tablighi Jamaat incident when I'll come to specific slides and talk about age groups and region. I think it'll be better to talk about this because this is just a general consolidated graph. So how did the people felt when they saw it? Many of them expected this, there is only a very small section who says those who have gathered were highly responsible. This doesn't actually meant that they were saying that such social media reaction was expected or was justified. They rather believe that being a minority in these times, they should have been more careful. So attitude of other communities, around 66.6% respondent claimed the attitude was bad, not only towards Tablighi Jamaat members, but towards the whole community. And they also shared their personal experience. But for us, the next option is the most important, I think is very important. A significant other said, either responded very vaguely or skipped the question or said they don't want to discuss this, which is again, the silences are very important. And see, the equal percentage said nothing. There was no such bad attitude. We will discuss this in detail later. So the general consolidated data of how they were mentally affected or economically affected or the socially affected, you can see a large population was at least, if not economically or socially affected, but mentally affected by the whole episode. Very important. Did you receive criticism within the Muslim community for holding any particular views on Tablighi Jamaat? And around 27% said yes, that they have received this. I'll also come back to this later. We asked them about the Shia leaders' response. Most of them hasn't heard about it. The first, that we haven't heard about their response. Few of them said it's wrong to say such thing. Many also cited internal conflict, and some said that they were always against the Jamaat. And the political interest is also cited as one of the reasons, and it will be very interesting in the later graphs to see that who were these people who actually said that the political interest is behind such strong condemnation. Later on, after, if you compare the initial response of the religious leader to later, you can see that people are now more vigilant. The religious leader were not more vigilant and asking them to take more precautions. But it is at the same time, it is important to look at this. You know, it will be wrong to assume that the change in the response or the more increase in the scientific percentage or asking for precaution increase just because this community was put under the scanner that led to the change to in the way people looked at the virus, but also because the virus become more real for people. And Tablighi Jamaat was the initial cases that came to India. So it is also has to do with that. So I think we should not just generalize like that. So did you feel burdened by the religious identity? This is again very interesting to look at that who were these 51 or 52% of the people who felt burdened by their identity after this incident. So coming to the specific response trend. So compared to females, males were initially relatively more scientific in their outlook to the pandemic. Additionally, a combined response, scientific and religious, is higher among females, while is negligible in the case of males. Also, higher portion of males viewed it as a conspiracy compared to females. But if you look at the later graph, compared to the initial view of being a conspiracy, males were later more religious in their beliefs regarding the pandemic as compared to the initial religious view, females were more scientific in their belief regarding the pandemic. Also, since it's not possible for me to show all the comparison or all the way we have looked at the data, so I'm going to only look, I'm only going to show the most significant differences I thought has very significant differences over something within a group. So higher portion of males viewed the incident as a conspiracy as compared to females. To elaborate on this, I think females viewed it higher as a genuine mistake. See, the reason the respondent could choose multiple option was, it was a conspiracy, was a central government doesn't actually said that it was not a genuine mistake. They said that it was a genuine mistake, but the whole episode was how it has turned out and commercialized was a conspiracy by the central government. But in both of this, you can see there is a section more in male, which says that they should not have gathered, lesser in female though. Male received more criticism from within the community for holding the particular views. Age groups. Outlook of the age group is more scientific in rationalizing the pandemic, whereas the outlook of the group, which is 30 to 50, is relatively more religious in rationalizing the pandemic. Also, the outlook of the elder group, which is the 51 to above, is highly, which above is actually the 82, is highly religious in rationalizing the pandemic. Later, a very significant increase in religious explanation of the pandemic for this middle group, whereas the decline in the conspiracy theories within this middle group. Majority of the young and the eldest views this incident as a genuine mistake, whereas the middle-aged group were of the opinion that this is being a conspiracy. Interestingly, not only young, but also elder group saw it more as a genuine mistake. And as far as the question of believing the popular narratives is concerned, there is a mixed response. Many people from different age groups and religions inclination believe that the religious that those narratives are partially true, citing their disbelief for the political narratives. However, few also found them that all of them are true, but some also said that they are exaggerated or illogical, mostly consisting of people who are youngster of young age or belong to the medical profession. But a very important point that is need to be made regarding this. What we noticed in the interview, that a significant number of youngsters with very high educational background, which had much more nuanced understanding of the human behavior. And whenever we asked them the answers, they gave an analytical explanation. Also, the dichotomy between the science and the religious. So whenever we put them questions which has a separate scientific and religious, they said, they were coming from a belief that they both don't contradict with each other. Also, very importantly, this young, highly educated Muslim group, we generally assume that of homogeneous opinions within the community and of sane, mature voices within the Muslim community do not exist. To counter that claim, this group also pointed out, and you see here the minority explanation being played out, you know, minority experience being played out here. So few amongst the same group also pointed out that there is no harm in believing the religious narratives. They were more tolerant of people's religious narratives and explanation, but said that the theories that demonize other needs to be countered. When the theory was about that, since it's a popular view that this is coming from bats. So they said, being a minority, they know what it is to be judged on the basis of their food and their lifestyle. So these narratives, and many of them actually shared that they did talk in detail about this to their family members against using these theories which demonizes other, and they should understand it more because they are suffering the same fate. So coming to the next slide about their opinions, So most very important, how far we can see the difference of sect and subsects within this young population, because most of the young population were aware till that whether they are Shia or Sunni, but were not aware about the school they belong to. And there is another section, but let me just complete this slide and then come to that. So the majority of young people haven't actually heard their responses, and they said it's wrong for them to say such thing. Though the middle-aged group, which I think understood these internal conflicts better, actually highlighted internal conflict being a reason. Here about the age group difference between economic and economic difference and the social economically affected by the whole episode or the socially affected by the whole episode. Almost the same percentage responded in every group were affected mentally. But in the middle group, you can see they were the most affected economically as well as socially among all the three age groups. The elders felt lowest burden of their identity because they said they have less interaction with people from other communities. Not only because there is a less interaction with people from other communities, but also citing their religious faith as the reason. So coming to the region, metropolitan, urban, and rural. So the Delhi responses will be in metropolitan. So metropolitan respondents were more scientific in belief. Urban respondents were more diverse, with high percentage of people being scientific, followed by belief of it as being a God's punishment. And all the rural respondents, you can see all the rural respondents looked at the pandemic as the God's punishment. But interestingly, among all the regions, when we talked about, they have not heard much about the popular narratives. And when we asked them what are their views about those popular narratives, they said that the rural respondents has the highest share of rational explanation on the popular narratives. And by that rational explanation, I mean not in terms of, they have their own colloquial way of making this rational explanation. For instance, they said, Jitne muh utni baatein. People will be there. There will be diverse opinions related to that. So, and metropolitan respondent looked at the incident as a genuine mistake, where urban and rural respondents were more inclined towards it being a conspiracy. And regarding the attitude of other communities after the incident, majority in all the regions has witnessed the gaslighting towards them, and many of them had also shared their personal experience. But you see, I want all of you to see the don't want to discuss in all in metropolitan, urban, and rural. It increases. Less people are afraid to speak up in metropolitan, and the higher people, around 32-34% people, do not want to discuss this. So these silences are very important, since the rural ones has most to lose economically as well as socially, which you can see in this slide. The rural respondents were least affected mentally, but by the whole episode, but were the most economically affected people across regions. Metropolitan respondent received the highest criticism from within the community. So you must be thinking why the metropolitan respondent received the highest criticism from within the community, because many of the metropolitan respondent is of the view that they should not have gathered, and the counter argument came to that. So in addition to metropolitan and urban respondent view that they haven't heard about it, or they were wrong in saying such thing. Many rural respondents were also of the view that Shia community or the Barelvi were always against Jamaat. So similarly, we have looked at the education as well. So both high class, very important, both high and middle income group were more scientific in their belief, whereas the lower income group had more religious view of the pandemic. Similarly, the general community was more scientific in their belief, whereas the OBC was more religious. All of them continued to have the similar kind of a view at the later stage also. A similar thing was witnessed in terms of education also. So we have divided the education into three. There are people who are above graduates, and then senior secondary to secondary to senior secondary. And there is they are the ones in the third group, which are eighth class to no institutional education at all. Below respondent, the last group, the eighth standard to below, were highly religious in their belief. The belief remains similar, and it remains similar at the later stage also, since they are the people who would also form the same. Okay, so the large part of high income group viewed this incident as a genuine mistake, whereas the middle and the low income group was more inclined towards it being a conspiracy. Among the income groups, low-income respondents remain highly affected mentally. You can see in the graph, the third one, economically and socially, remain highly affected mentally and not only socially, but also economically, the low-income group. So the low-income group were highly burdened by the identity after the incident also. Similarly, in education also, people with education lower than eighth or no institutional education were the one who were the most economically impacted, since these are also the people with low income group. Most of them fall under the low income group. Religious inclination. So people with high religious inclination were more were both scientific and religious in belief, whereas people with lower inclination were more scientific in their belief. People with high religious inclination actually mentioned that there isn't a dichotomy between the scientific and religious. Very interestingly, people with low religious inclination felt more burdened by the identity. Coming to another group, sects divide. So Sunni, Shia, there is another third group which is equally important, which is didn't knew or didn't want to share. And what does this group constitute of whom? So yeah, mainly who didn't knew consisted of the youngster who didn't knew, which was not very large portion, which was higher in terms of when will come to the which school they belong to, but didn't want to share came of a conscious thing. They didn't wanted to share this detail, and they said that they do, citing their disbelief in the division of sects and subsects. And the reason we are focusing more on this division of Sunni and Shia is because not all division within the Muslim community manifest at the political level. So that's why we are concentrating on Shia and Sunni more. But very importantly, contrary to the popular belief, most Shia viewed this as a genuine mistake. And it being a conspiracy is higher in Shia than in Sunni. That's why I said that the opinion of the Shia leaders cannot be taken as the opinions of the Shia public. So most of the respondents cited internal conflict within the community as the reason for this. Few only mentioned that Shia community were always against the Jamaat. But contrary to the popular belief, Shia community were unaware of such demands and finds the political motivation as the reason behind such strong and unjust demands. So I pointed out earlier that I'll come back to who are the people who said that the political motivation is behind this strong condemnation. That were the people from Shia community. Tablighi Jamaat, but I'll come back to this, but there is also a section within the Shia community which felt that because of the wrongdoings of the Devbandi sect, Tablighi Jamaat, they also have to go through all this. But by and large, Shia community is divided on the issue of Jamaat, just like people belonging to other sect. And mainly, I think it's a few political leaders whose opinions seems to have created this divide of us.
It's already 2:00 and you have taken almost 1 hour.
Okay, I'll just end in 5 minutes. I think it's just going to end. I'll just skip a few slides. This is the last one and then I'll conclude. I'll go for the more important one. Okay, this is more important when we come to subsects, Devbandi and Bareilvi. As I have also pointed out that the Ala Hazrat Trust also demanded a ban for the Tablighi Jamaat, nationwide ban. The large portion of Bareilvi section also didn't know about this demand. And you can see that, in fact, in the opinions regarding this, they thought that the Tablighi Jamaat is unjustly targeted. Bareilvi sect also felt the same. And this is the last set of comparison where section that didn't knew or didn't wanted to share felt more burdened by their religious identity. So, rather than giving you this broader observation of this, I think we have covered all of this. I'll conclude my presentation since I think the data has spoken for itself. And with all these slides, we have laid bare the idea of homogeneous Muslim opinion. And I conclude with this, that we have witnessed three kind of popular narratives in this whole thing, which was one is of a religious based explanation narrative, which will be this is Allah's punishment and so on and so forth. And general conspiracy theories that were going by, which is this is being international conspiracies. But third, the most important for us is with the Hindutva situation motivated rationalization, of which you can also sell the minority complex narrative, which said that this is this pandemic is taking place to counter the NRC or to stop the NRC and CA, which is initiated by the central government. So although respondents were divided in their opinions about the Tablighi Jamaat incident, majority were united in their support against the banning and how the organization was targeted and was called the terrorist organization. What is very important to bring in here, you know, the outside debate was majorly related to outside debate regarding this whole episode was related to the attack on Muslims. Even in mature conversation, it was about attacking Tablighi Jamaat, if not all Muslims. Therefore, a narrative of good or bad Muslims, a binary which Hindutva likes to evoke from time to time being played out. But within the community, as many would not expect, a more extensive or a more reflective sort of conversation took place regarding this debate. So within the community, the conversation extended to the role of such organizations in social, economic, and educational backwardness of the community. So many people or many highly educated ones or not so highly educated ones, people belonging to Tablighi Jamaat only, people belonging to Devbandi sects only, said that the Tablighi Jamaat member didn't say for the ban, but many said that the organization shouldn't be banned because of this incident, as they do not believe that they have spread the virus intentionally or extensively. But one can't ignore that it's a highly regressive organization and its outlook to the disease is problematic according to them. And most importantly, their role in keeping the community socially and educationally backward is of most priority to these people. So, but having said that, the young, well-educated generation was more tolerant of the organization, and their belief system is showing a multi-layered gray understanding of the matter rather than of black and white. But later, cutting across the ideological divide, many Muslim religious scholars of Sufi school and even Barelvi came together on the question of communalization. Even those who have called out for earlier ban. But that's why the section which criticized the Tablighi Jamaat on the base, Shia section of Shia, which criticized Tablighi Jamaat, saying that now they have to, because of them, they have to face the sect identity. This sect identity in our responses was not visible within the divide of Sunni, Barelvi and Devbandi. And as you know, that the communalization has a tendency to homogenize. Often the response seems to be, the reaction that comes often seems to be homogenous, but that's not happening here. The majority did condemn the communalization, but their views remain very diverse and the conversation extended beyond communalization, even within Tablighi Jamaat for that matter. So the sect identity was most prominent only in the case of Shia Sunni divide, not in terms of Devbandi and Barelvi. And without any surprise, later many religious scholars from Sufi school of thought and also the Barelvi who had earlier condemned Tablighi Jamaat came together to condemn the communalization. So Devbandi and Barelvi seems to be more united in their response to this communalization in comparison with Shia community. So this is my reading of the data. More, I don't want to be limited to the way that I have looked at the data. So I'm very keen on hearing your inputs and observation. And thank you for listening to this long presentation. So over to you. Thank you.
Thank you, Yerka, for an excellent presentation. Very enjoyable. And by the way, data does not speak for itself. It was you who were giving us the interpretation. So data is something which can be interpreted in different and multiple ways. And it was your interpretation which provided some kind of a frame to make sense of what you collected. So again, I really enjoyed your presentation. I have a few things to say, but I would like to, I would like others to begin. If you have any question or comment, please feel free to make it.
Seems participants are convinced by her argument. There is no question, not even in the chat box. And also there is, we are taking lots of time for each presentation, but as the convener, I must tell the chair and also other who are present here, we decided to give a fuller understanding, a better understanding of the data we have, because we are really interested in getting feedback and questions.
Yes, that's so it's very important. Feedbacks are important.
As I said, that first thing which I really appreciate
I can't hear you.
Yeah. Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Yeah. I think there's some problem with my internet connection. So let me fix it. Okay, yeah. So, first of all, what I really like in the entire project, and especially with this presentation, is the framing. You know, we all collect data, we all, you know, get into the messiness of empirical realities, but the framing exercise is a difficult exercise. In both the presentation and especially with Zarqa's presentation, I really appreciate the manner in which companies present that, you know, that...
So we have lost you again.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Let me reconnect myself, yeah?
Zarqa, can you stop sharing your screen because I have to.
Hello, can you hear me now?
Yes.
To first of all, as I said, that I really like the framing exercise, which you have done in an excellent manner. You know, all these things are there and many things are quite commonsensical. But it was your framing that makes them resilient. In terms of the quality and the presentation, it's excellent. Having said that, I have a few things to say. Not as questions, but as feedback. Yeah. So the first feedback, I would come to the Shia point. That's an important point later, but not now. The first feedback is the intentionality point. You also said in your passing reference. I think let me just quickly go back with the first thing. It is about the contextualization of the Muslim problem in colonial and post-colonial India. I think that the point which you made with regard to who had right to vote should be more highlighted. Because that's the point which is your point. It's not coming out from somewhere. You have discovered it. So you should make it quite confidently as something in order to show the diversity or the diversified opinion historically. So that's the first thing which I think important. The second thing is about the intentionality, the cartoons which you showed, etc. Where the issue was that, you know, Muslims were doing intentionally. So this intention should be, you know, unpacked. And if we closely look at the material which you presented, especially the visual material which you presented, it states Muslims more religious than others, and they would do everything by following religion. Second is that they are homogeneous and they would follow their religious elites. And finally, they are anti-Hindu in nature. So these three things must be clearly spelled out. So the intentionality point is a very crucial point. It must be unpacked. And in my view, it could be unpacked in these three ways. Yeah. Now, reconfiguration of religious identity is something which I find fascinating. And as I said to Sadia, that, you know, all these things would ask us, would force to ask a new set of questions. So if that is the case, then one question would be that how the idea of self-criticism is internal to contemporary religiosity. Self-criticism. And this self-criticism is not coming out from so-called rational scientific framework. It is coming out from the religious text itself and amalgamated in a different form. The young imam, which you mentioned in your presentation, can be a figure to know more about it. The idea of self-criticism. Remember, this idea of self-criticism is very central politically in left circles. Left were always self-critical. And except Hindutva, you know, that's a very important distinction between other political forces and the Hindutva is that Hindutva, you do not have self-criticism. The possibility of self-criticism is completely unimaginable in the Hindutva discourses. But in Muslim religiosity, as well as left circles politically, you may find self-criticism as a way to find out the answers. And this is something which, and that this is something which both Dayanand Saraswati and Gandhi highlighted. Remember, if you read Satyat Prakash, Dayanand Saraswati highlighted the fact that we must criticize caste system, etc., in order to develop a rational. It's a case with Gandhi, who would argue that we must have some kind of a self-criticism to evolve a new kind of religiosity. But the contemporary form of Islamic self-criticism is entirely new, and therefore it requires some more explanation. Okay, so that's the third thing which I would like to point out. The fourth thing is your finding that it was actually expected. It points towards what we call normalization. And we tend to hear this in terms of cartoon, secular, liberal voices. It's a new normal. This new normal is, one is we can take it as a phrase. The other way is to take it as a concept. We take the normal as a concept and try to and look at in how many ways this normal goes. So in my view, there are two very prominent ways in which Muslim responses can be articulated with regard to this normalization. One is that the acceptance that BJP is the dominant party. And this acceptance is that now BJP's hegemony is functioning as the political correctness of our time. Say 10 years ago, where Congress's hegemony was dominant and BJP was always seen as a challenger. Now BJP has established its hegemony, and BJP's hegemony is acceptable not merely by the political class, but also by the Muslims in different ways. So the acceptance of hegemony that it's a Hindu Rashtra, or it's, you know, whether it's a Hindu Rashtra or not, it does not matter. But BJP's political is something which is a dominant explanatory template which is accepted by Muslims. So that's one thing. And at the same time, what they are doing, they are trying to search new ways to accommodate themselves in this emerging hegemonic framework. And therefore, many of your findings indicate towards that. It was expected that after, and you are right, you have made a very crucial point that before the advent of corona or pandemic, it was there. It was already in the dominant sphere, in the dominant public discourse. And therefore, the contextualization is something which can provide us new meanings to this normalization. So therefore, this new normal is quite like 1950s North India. In 1950s, it was acceptable for Muslim to take the blame. And by the way, like 1950s, it was also at the moment, you may find that the society is also communalized completely. Remember, we often take that leaders are responsible for everything and common people are the good people. No, that's not true. Common people are equally responsible for the ways in which political classes are responsible for that. And therefore, we have to understand the everydayness of normalization. So Muslim communities are evolving new ways to accommodate themselves in this everydayness which is emerging since 2014. Therefore, we to unpack this everydayness again. Yeah. So the religiosity, scientificism, and staying. No. What is interesting is that Muslims are not, you know, moving away from the political discourse. They are intervening in the politics, but in a refined way. What is that refined way? Which we need to actually unpack. This is something which we really don't know. Now, your two things which I think should also, as I said, that I really enjoyed your presentation. What I usually do, I like what you said and my questions, and it was so good that you were responding to all the questions which I was highlighting. So that's why I said that this fascinating framing. So therefore, but there are two things which I thought that you should develop. First is that you did not pay close attention to the first point which you made. That was the idea of communalization and using law for communalization. The anti-Muslim discourse, and you indicated three points. One is that special jails were created. Second, separate numbers of Muslim corona patients were given. And third is that certain FIRs were registered, not merely by Yogi Adityanath, but our great Arvind Kejriwal. Now, these three things, these three things are also contributing or indicating three modes in which communalization or anti-Muslim discourse is created. So you have using law. Second, that you won't allow the person who is the charges to respond because the lockdown has happened. So you are putting them in jail. And finally, you are creating a category through law to influence the social discourse or the media discourse. And this is something which Nehru was very critical in 50s. Remember, in 50s, it was acceptable to use Hindu and Muslim as reporting categories. But editor guilds, editor guilds at that time, but Ministry of Information and Broadcasting, when it was constituted, it was the part of Home Ministry at that time in 50s, they issued a circular under Nehru's that we should avoid using Hindu and Muslim as reporting categories. So therefore, one community or two majority community and minority community, the phrases we have in newspapers. Now that phrasing has completely gone. Hindu killed Muslim, Muslim killed Hindu. That's a colonial discourse and we are reproducing it. So creating a category in the public discourse is something which is very crucial, and you indicated that, but I would like you to develop it more. Now the final point, which is a fascinating point, as I said, but it requires some more thinking. It's about the diversity which you underline. One way of representing diversity is to just give the factual account of it. So the specific manner in which diversity can be theorized is to look at the ways in which certain categories are invoked and they are treated against. In your case, and I completely agree with you, the Shia, Bareilly, these are the given binaries which are constituted with regard to Sunni. But as you said, as you showed, that the Shia response shouldn't be interpreted through Shia leaders. Obviously, Mukhtar Abbas Naqvi cannot be treated as Shia leader at all, because 33% said that it was a conspiracy by the central government. It means that, but at the same time, we also have to, then the question is, as I said, theoretically, we have to unpack the category called Shia. Because Shia, remember that Shia Sunni is a broad, if I'm making a painting, it's a broad stroke. But the fine stroke would be what kind of Shia we are talking about. And especially North India. What is their economic background? What are their political inclination? So therefore, that and same is applicable to Bareilvi thing. And when you said that many did not mention their sect-oriented affiliation, that's also an important finding, because it underlines the fact that somehow Tablighi Jamaat, because the propaganda was, we have to get rid of this sect kind of binaries. We must get rid of that. So it means that Tablighi Jamaat is the dominant, at least among Sunnis, is a dominant form of religiosity. So when this form of religiosity was challenged, different kind of responses emerged. Now, the point is, when we unpack Barel, again, this Barelviyat is something which required some, you know, very specific degree. Barelvi set, because, you know, Barelvi is a misleading theory. Somehow we missed the point. We imagine that every dargah is a Barelvi dargah. We imagine every sect is a, you know, is every shrine is. So I think that detailing required in order to show that what do we mean by Barelvi sect specifically. And remember, Barelvi sect is more rigid in practices than the Devbandi. If we talk about Devbandi sect and the Barelvi sect comparatively. Now, this is about the thing which with regard to, yeah. The final point is about CEA and NRC controversy. In the pre-communalization period, Muslims were responding as citizen. Now, you can also underline the fact that at that very point, it was the dominant assertion of citizenship by the Muslim communities. And that dominant assertion somehow contributed for asserting as citizen. So remember, I think we should not overstress this point about Shaheen Bagh. Because Muslim participation, if you look at Muslim participation in formal electoral politics and non-formal social movement type politics, you may find these communities were either communities, but calling themselves a citizen. What was significant about Shaheen Bagh and anti-CEA protest was that this identity somehow, the identity of a Muslim citizen, somehow got into the realm of mainstream. It was not in the mainstream. So therefore, asserting citizenship to underlying specific Indian Muslim identity is something which is coming out of it. And I really appreciate the way in which you link these two up. So these are my feedback. Having said that, I congratulate you. And this is a fantastic, you know, paper. And I look forward for reading it if you write. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, sir. I expected for giving me this excellent framework to theorize it. That's what I was looking from you. Thank you so much for that. The point that you have mentioned about the Imam, I think I missed making this point. So I think the response within the Tablighi Jamaat and those who said that they shouldn't have gathered, suggested to two things, according to me. One is the fear psychosis of speaking about it at this stage, and another was of a genuine internal conflict, or what you said, disagreement, which you said is allowed within this, rather than that will be allowed in the Hindutva narrative. And my findings actually suggest towards both fear psychosis as well as towards the internal disagreements. And the internal disagreement were more on the basis of age group, according to the data that we have seen. It is the young people who tend not to agree with it. So this Imam from Tablighi Jamaat was very, he condemned Maulana Saad for hiding. He said, if he hasn't done anything wrong, why he should be hiding? And in the religious zeal, he gave statements that he shouldn't have given earlier, you know. So the data also suggests towards these two things. But thanks for giving me this excellent way to framework to theorize this. And thank you very much.
The program now. Are we going to continue with the third presentation now, or shall we take a break for 2-3 minutes?
No, I think let's take a break for 5 minutes.
Okay.
I'm very sorry, but I have an office meeting from 3. I can't. I thought this will be till 2:30 maximum, and I said yes to office meeting at 3. That's why I'm worried.
Oh, but you should have actually write in the text box, so we could have done that.
I texted Dr. Chakraborty that this is taking too long. Can we fast forward it?
Yeah. So what is your suggestion now?
I can maybe try to like present my findings. It's not too long anyway, because these other two people, they actually covered a lot of area and mine is smaller. It's just West Bengal and it's just a part of it. So if I may, if that's okay with you, if I may, I can start presenting and then.
Yeah. I think that's that perfect
case. I'm sorry and sorry for the inconvenience and thank you.
But because, you know, we are recording it, so we will have some kind of discussion after your presentation and yes. You can have access to that.
Yes.
If that is all right with you.
Yeah, sure.
Yeah. Okay. Fine.
Thank you so much. Okay. So I hope you guys can see my screen.
Yeah.
Okay, so I will not get too much into the introduction, except the fact that Indian society already had so much borders, societal borders in itself. We had fault lines along the class of gender, along the lines of gender, class, religion. And these fault lines and borders have deepened since the COVID-19 pandemic, because as we see, as we have seen the migrant crisis and this communalization of the pandemic, these borders have deepened. And the Muslim community, which has already been discriminated against for a very long time, be it Babri case or CANRC or recent the Babri Masjid, judgment. We have seen the discrimination happening, and during COVID-19, nothing changed. So this, I will not go over Tablighi Jamaat again, because my colleagues have wonderfully explained the entire case of Tablighi Jamaat already. So I will, this aim we know already, it's the Pan-India response, and I'm looking at the West Bengal, the response of West Bengal state. So a bit of background, West Bengal, has one of the highest rates of coronavirus in India. And we can see more than 2 lakh people are so far affected in West Bengal. And even though the rate of survival is also good, but it's, the cases are increasing now. Now, the Tablighi Jamaat case in West Bengal, what happened was, Zarqa has said how state governments and media has shown specific numbers of Tablighi Jamaat people who are affected because of coronavirus. What happened in West Bengal, the government had identified 65 people. Again, a news article from April 4, 2020 said the West Bengal government had identified 65 people from this state who attended the congregation in Delhi and then quarantined 200 who came in contact with these 65 attendees. Of the 58 people who were affected, 7 had died and 12 have been discharged. Few days later, another national media, NDTV, wrote that meanwhile, some other reports, which is not government reports, have claimed that 300 people have attended the religious congregation from Bengal and 109 from our foreigners and 995 from West Bengal. So there's 109 from foreigners. Now we have to remember, West Bengal has already been targeted by our ruling dispensation for harboring illegal immigrants, that means Bangladeshi. So when people say there are 109 foreigner Jamaatis, it almost always mean that illegal Bangladeshis or other illegal Muslims, Rohingyas, they are here and they are harming our population. So these are the main views that we get when we talk about foreigners in context of West Bengal. However, when the reporters asked Mamata Banerjee, our chief minister, about this data, chief minister said that she asked the media persons not to ask such a communal question because she didn't want to share specific numbers from West Bengal regarding the Tablighi Jamaat case. Now, there's a reason for that. West Bengal, unlike UP or the Cowbelt, has seen less communal violence. I won't say it hasn't, but it has seen less communal violence. Now, many have attributed it because of the long left rule we had here, or because of the current political party, which has also been accused of appeasing the Muslim minorities. But yes, they are not
communal in that sense, in a very open, overtly communal party. So we have to see the history of West Bengal a bit, which I will focus more. So this section, actually, I'm tracking from the pre-independence history, where I'm starting from the 1905 Bengal division, which in colloquial terms we call Bongo Bongo. So in 1905, during the British colonial rule, this partitional Bongo Bongo has been started by Lord Curzon, the then Viceroy of India. He wanted to divide Bengal. He argued that Bengal presidency was far too large for them to administer properly. It was formally announced on 19th of July and implemented 3 months later on 16th October 1905. It meant creation of a new province of Eastern Bengal and Assam. The new province of Eastern Bengal would have a population of 31 million, of which 18 million will be Muslims and 12 million Hindus, while the remaining province of Bengal will have a population of 54 million Hindus and 9 million Muslims. While Lord Curzon justified this partitioning as an administrative decision, many historians, just like noted historian Shekhar Bandyopadhyay said, had the partition been purely on administrative grounds, then the government would have accepted the alternative proposals offered by a number of civil servants, suggesting more logical partition plans based on linguistic division rather than religious division of the population. But Curzon rejected all these proposals on political ground that linguistic unity would further consolidate the position of Bengali politicians. Now, the Hindus of the Eastern province rejected this partition and it made them the minority in East. And then the violent agitation started against this partition, which also developed into a strong nationwide Swadeshi movement. Finally, in 1911, Lord Hardinge, the then Viceroy of India, unified Bengal again. So this overwhelming rejection of Bengali Hindus against the partition was seen as a rejection of Muslim communities' development, because the Muslim community thought this partition will, I'm not going to say that all the whole community, because as we have seen in our previous presentations and discussions, that Muslim community is not homogeneous, and obviously there are vested interests of certain part of the community in some place. So, but according to the history, majority of the Muslims saw this as a development opportunity, which the Hindus stopped for rejecting partition. Now it sold the division of it sold the communal seat between the two communities. However, what wasn't achieved in 1905 was achieved in 1947, when the colonial power divided the territory into two countries, India and Pakistan. Now Bengal and Punjab bore the brunt of partition, and according to 1946 legislative elections, the Muslim League in West Bengal won the highest number of votes. However, this demand for a separate nation was in makings for decades. And according to another noted historian, Joya Chatterjee, she said she attributes a central role to Bengali elite Bengali Hindus in spearheading the campaign that led to the division of province in 1947. She argues that the public demands for partition and a separate homeland for Bengali Hindus on the eve of partition reflected the end result of a decisive shift from nationalism to communalism that had marked Bengal politics and identity from the 1930s. However, unlike Punjab, the partition of Bengal, because partition of Bengal and post-partition communal violence also played an important role in developing a Muslim subjectivity in West Bengal. So unlike Punjab, the history of partition in the East and its effect was a continuous one. Immediately after the partition in 1948, violent riots in the districts of Barishal, Pabna, Rangpur, which is now Bangladesh, were resulted, and Bengali Hindus crossed over to India. This riot played a crucial role in developing an anti-Muslim sentiment in this part of Bengal, West Bengal. Now, the 1950 riot, the next riot of 1950, it was very important because it was actually basically started by West Pakistan to identify communists in East Pakistan, erstwhile East Pakistan, now Bangladesh. And when they started identifying communists, this communist for West Pakistan was basically Hindus. So they started identifying, and then there was a clash in one of the small villages in East Pakistan where some policemen, West Pakistani police, died, which led to anti-Hindu operation. So the anti-communist operation turned into anti-Hindu operation, which led to a huge migration,
huge refugee crisis, where many Hindus from Bangladesh came to West Bengal, and they were in one of the main, they came to Calcutta, and the one of the main railway stations of Calcutta, Sialdah, was swarming with Hindus. The news covered it so much and gave so much, like published so many human tragedy stories, that anti-Muslim sentiment became very strong. And then there were riots here, which led to witch hunting of Muslims in West Bengal. And that finally led to a Nehru-Liaquat Pact in 1950, which assured government protection of minority communities in each country. Then this this anti-Muslim idea, anti-Muslim sentiment, waned during the 1971 Bangladesh Liberation War. So at that point, even though the most of the refugees during 1971 Bangladesh Liberation War again were Hindus, but a significant number of Muslim refugees came to West Bengal, Tripura, Assam, Meghalaya, even Nagaland. And the idea was, it was a linguistic nationalism. So Bengalis here identified with that linguistic nationalism. Hence, the anti-Muslim sentiment went. So especially in West Bengal, there was a lot of effort to rehabilitate the refugees, to provide them shelter, protection, food, and of course, help them in their return journey. And then obviously in the 1971, West Bengal had another important event. We started having this radical left guerrilla movement, Naxalbari, which also kind of downplayed the role of religion in society, and a class-based lens started forming in the mind of Bengalis here. So that was another point. Now, if we see the percentage of Muslims in West Bengal, as per the 2001 census, it was found out that 25.25% of population are Muslim, West Bengal population. And according to the 2011 census, it was 27%. However, the 2007 Sacher Committee report found out the Muslims have witnessed the lowest degree of development since independence. And the same for West Bengal. So despite having a quote-unquote progressive leftist government, the Muslims have not developed equally, equally like their other communities. So, next, this is a very important point. While my colleagues have talked about social media, I really cannot, because when I was studying social media for this report, all the viral hashtags, everything I could find was in either Hindi or in English. Even the WhatsApp forwards that we got, my friends got, my relatives got, are in Hindi or English, which speaks volume about the dominance of a particular language over the other regional languages, and which is increasing because of our current political scenario. Let's go to a sample profile of our respondents. Now we see gender, it's more male than female. Current place of living, it's very important, because when the coronavirus started, people were in rural areas were really not following anything. And we have actually two most highest number of districts. One is Murshidabad. Murshidabad has one of the highest highest population of Muslims in India. So when we contacted people in Murshidabad, they were like, really, there's nothing happening. It's okay, God is with us. So this is there. And then we have, so rural area is very important when we are talking about this report. And then we have the urban population here, which is the majority. Highest qualification. So my respondents were mostly postgraduate or higher, and followed by people with research degrees. And I didn't have anybody who didn't have a school degree or lower than 8th, actually. Occupation, most of my respondents are teachers or professors, then students, NGOs, and else. Well, this is very interesting because while we see a lot of religious, not religious sponsors, but believers in other two presentation, I have a significant number of atheists as my respondents. Now, that speaks volume about the kind of community, Muslim community West Bengal has, or the progress in terms of sociocultural progress this community has made. I'm not saying atheism is progress. I'm saying what kind of progress towards, it can be a backward progress, forward progress. I'm not making any judgments or comments regarding that. Now, very interestingly, when I asked them the same question about the caste, sect, and school of the Muslims here, majority didn't know. Of course, majority of them belong in the Sunni community, but when I come to the caste and school, people were not aware of what they are. And when I would talk to them on the phone, asking them, okay, what is your caste, what is your school, they would visibly get irritated. Why are you asking me this question? This is, we don't know. What's the point of this? So that's another trend. I have, when we talk about how religious do you consider yourself to be, one being not at all religious, do not even know, I don't even go to the festivals or anything. And the 10 is, I'm so religious. These two are the highest and equal. And then the next is the middle ground that, okay, more or less religious. Again, I have a high section of people who belong to the middle class and also a high section of people who, followed by people who earn less than 25,000 a month, which is, we can put in lower class. Language is spoken at home. Most of them are Bengali. At work, Bengali, Hindi, English. And with friends, Bengali mixed English. So, now coming to the subjective response, this is a general responses. So most of them have given a scientific response. Now I could, I was hearing Dr. Hilal's comments on Sadia's and Zarka's presentation, and I agree with him. Religious doesn't mean not scientific. But when, at least I divided my responses, because these are subjective responses, I put the religious response as those who very clearly said that, oh, this is God's punishment, or this is, everything will be fine because Allah is there. And the scientific response mostly had, like, they had in mind the health crisis, the health issues, the that they are believing in doctors and they should have much more facilities. So this was the divide, this was the divide I made. Again, these are the narratives that people heard more. And regarding the Kashmir narrative, my respondents were not very keen on answering that they heard the Kashmir narrative. So I have clubbed this into other narratives because those were really less. Okay, about the narratives, most of them thought it's illogical. Many didn't even think about them. And very few people agreed with the narratives. This case is about the Tablighi Jamaat case. See how many people actually thought they shouldn't have gathered. And very interestingly, women, more than men, thought they shouldn't have gathered. Women were much more strict when it came to Tablighi Jamaat case. They were like, they shouldn't have gathered. And this is, and with the narratives, this is illogical. So it presents a very interesting data that when we talk about women or when we talk about gender, women are shown as much, much more primordial, much more religious. But here women are like, no, they shouldn't have gathered. Mentally, economically, socially, everybody. So I put all in mixed because some people said they have been affected mentally and socially. Some said socially and economically, and some said by all. So that's where I put all in mixed and see how many people actually didn't get any effect. I don't know if because of their class position or because of their religiosity or because they are sociocultural elite. Actually, I'm coming to that, but they have not faced much effect. How do you feel about the pandemic after the Jamaat incident? It's a no change in views. This no change in views does not mean that these are all scientific views. This no change in views means either they were holding religious views and it didn't change, or they were holding scientific views and it didn't change. And when I asked this thing, many people very explicitly said Tablighis were not responsible. That was a question. They didn't say what their views was about the pandemic now. They said Tablighis were not responsible. That's why I made it a separate category, which was a big category. And then there were some people who said their views have changed towards more scientific views. So now, when I'm talking about the pandemic and how they're viewing it now, the majority, as you can see, they're viewing it as a health crisis. While some people are saying it's Allah's punishment, and there are still some people who are saying they're not too worried. I'm not judging. Okay. I asked this question. There was another question I asked before. Did they go to Eidgah for namaz? Because since the lockdown started, after the Tablighi Jamaat incident, since the lockdown started, there was Eid. There were two Eids, if I'm not wrong. And even though there were congregations of Hindu communities, Muslims were specifically told by their maulvis, by their local religious leaders, do not go to namaz, do not go to pray. Because we kept hearing that if they go to pray, the BJP or the majority in community is ready to lynch in the sense social media lynch them, or even worse in Cowbelt maybe. But when I asked, did they go to pray? They said they didn't. Most majority, 90% of them said they didn't. 10% said yes. When I asked why they didn't go, they said very clearly, they said health and safety reason, they're lockdown. 14.6% people said they're atheist or they don't offer namaz because of some reason or the other, health reason, or they're agnostic, they believe in other things, but they don't do namaz, paanch waqt. Some said they have a fear of repression from the government. That's why they didn't go. And this non-applicable one, it was interesting to see many people didn't even want to comment on it. Now, I don't know whether it was because they went and they don't want to tell anybody, or they just didn't want to comment on a question like this. I tried to follow up, but they said we have said no comments or non-applicable, so it's non-applicable. Now, I didn't do, actually I had specific graphs, but I thought I will actually not do that and go through very few interesting points that I find important or I find interesting for my paper, my area. As I said previously, more women believe that Tablighi Jamaat should not have gathered, whereas more men believe that it's a genuine mistake. The age group. So when I was doing the specific graphs, I have put three age groups, 18 to 31, 18 to 30, 31 to 50, 51 to 77. Very interestingly, 51 to 77 age group had more scientific view of rationalizing the pandemic, while more younger people held a sympathetic view or sympathized with the Jamaatis. Now, when I was trying to find an intersectional answer to this, I saw this young people, which I have mentioned in my fourth point, this young group, 18 to 30 group, they are mostly middle class. And more of them are atheist, but they chose to be politically correct. When I say they chose to be politically correct is that they were very conscious about how they were answering. And this older group, they were answering like they believe it. And this 51 to 77, we say these older people are much more religious and younger ones are not. But a question, are we living in that kind of globalized neoliberal community where alienation is so much that even though you are atheist, you belong to the community and you really cannot alienate your community, especially the current political crisis that the Muslim community is facing. Many atheist youngsters are also finding relief in the sense of community, because Muslim community is not only a religious community anymore. It goes beyond the religiosity. It's a socio-political community now. And the older people, I have an interesting anecdote. I was talking to this old farmer from Murshidabad, and they were, and he was diehard, like hardcore CPM supporter. So he said, why will I ever sympathize with these Jamaatis? Like, and these people, they have done CPM since they were young, and they are still believing in that party, in that idea, in that ideology. So this is a very interesting trend for rural-urban divide. Again, very interestingly, many of the rural respondents rejected the religious explanation of the virus, whereas a significant number of urban population gave a more religious-based answer. Which begs the question, are the urban population more religious or they are more open and they have a more like, well, I don't want to say politically correct again and again because that can sometimes have a very negative connotation, but for lack of a better word. More people from lower and upper class background faced economic crisis because of the communalization than middle income group. And middle class people, as I said, then more politically correct, especially 1830. The last point, more respondents who are neither atheist nor strongly religious sympathize with Tablighi Jamaat while the agreed with the initial narratives. And people who are strongly religious, most of them did not sympathize with Tablighi Jamaat. And they have also, and the middle group also had the religious group also had a very skewed view towards the scientific explanation. Why? The final, I will come to the why later, the next slide. Some observation, majority respondents already had a scientific view when we started talking about the virus, pre-communalization. Their attitude to the pandemic was very scattered and they were very confused, just like everyone. One of us, we were scared, confused, anxious, we didn't know. So it was the same for these people. Then they saw it has a health crisis, even pre and post communalization. Another observation, people were extremely scared to talk to us. When we tried to interview all of us, people did not want to talk to us. Even when we said that we will not use your name, they said, no, but you have so many other identifying markers that people can know who we are. Especially you're asking about our income group, where we're living, gender, everything. So it's easy. That's another reason why my next slide, I feel it's very important. There are some questions that I need to ponder, or we all maybe collectively need to ponder upon. Did we really get honest responses from our respondents? Because the community has been vilified to a level that maybe they thought that it's their burden to be scientific, to be rational, rather than be honest and be like, okay, no, I still believe it's Allah's punishment. I don't believe that this virus can harm us or something like that, because I believe Allah will protect us. Did the respondents criticize Tablighi Jamaat because they had to? And what now for the community? How they move forward from here? So these are the questions I am pondering upon while also trying to get a sense of why our mainstream idea of gender, age group, rural-urban divide are all being challenged in this report, in my report. Why it's been challenged, why it's so different from what we have thought or we know as the normal. As Dr. Hilal said, is this the new normal? Is this how Muslim community adapting to it? Or is it because there is some sense of urgency among the people to fit into the narrative of modernization, or progressive, or they are not barbaric, uncivilized community which is trying to harm a very docile and a very upper caste Mother India. So these are the things, and I'm done. And thank you for patiently hearing me. And I'm so sorry for rushing through everything.
No, thank you very much. It's really, really fascinating. And the most important thing is the honest question.
I'm sorry, sir, but you're breaking actually so much.
Yeah. So can we have some discussion before you, or would you like to say something?
I just texted that I will be 10 minutes late, but we have 15 minutes. Okay.
Oh, great. So, if anyone has any question or comment, please make that. Otherwise, I have a few things to say.
Yeah. Am I audible?
Yeah.
Yeah. So I have one question for you. You said that the younger generation wants to be politically correct. That's why they're responding in terms of that. Yeah. So my findings of the findings of my data has also been the same, but the conclusion that I drew from it has been a little different. So you said they are, why do you think that they are responding in terms of the political correctness that you say and not in terms of their current social political reality? And being an atheist does not matter, because that's not how they are looked from outside. So why do you think so? It's the political correctness in the region that is driving force in the young people for saying what they are saying, being sympathetic towards Tablighi Jamaat, and not the reality that they are living in currently.
Okay. Very good question. Thank you. So let me clarify about things about my young, most of my young respondent group actually came from activist background. These are left, like radical left political activists. Okay. So what happens is when they are saying something, they try to be very politically correct. I mean, for example, they might personally disagree with Tablighi Jamaat, but when they are answering somebody, they'll be like, okay, no, but let's talk about it. And they're also very mindful that even if they criticize Tablighi Jamaat, they know that their answers can be taken and used in a certain way by the majoritarian community or Hindutva supporters. So it's not just for my report that they do it, and I think they did it for my report also, but they do it whenever they're having public or a conversation about this kind of politics. So that's one of the reason I think they have taken a much more politically correct aspect.
Any other question?
I don't think we have other questions.
Okay.
There is one. Yes.
Yes, my survey was anonymous, but I do know the people personally, so I contacted them and followed up with them when I had some clarifications to make. Yes.
Okay. Thanks. Any other question? Okay. Since, you know, first of all, I enjoyed your presentation. A few things. Again, these are not questions for you. These are just as a reader of a text. These are my responses, or what you call a reader response theory. First of all, West Bengal thing, case study is significant in two ways. And whenever you write your report, you also underline the fact that West Bengal, the location of West Bengal as a political entity, the present context is very powerful and different. Therefore, we must, assert that. Because why West Bengal? Your point about population and such a report are well taken, but there is another symbolic relationship between West Bengal as a state ruled by first by left for many years and by Mamata Banerjee later. Now there is, BJP is going there as some kind of a challenger. So therefore the study of West Bengal is crucial, not merely because of the presence of Muslim, but also its symbolic location in the present political discourse. So this is the first point which I would like to make. Second point is that, if you compare West Bengal, not with Delhi, but say with Kerala, you may find some interesting trends. First of all, if you look at India's response to COVID, and I have an interesting interview with Quint, if you want, you can have, that's available. It came out before the Tablighi Jamaat controversy. And I was not here, I was in Europe. And so Quint conducted that interview. They wanted me to compare Indian situation with the situation in Europe. And what I found very striking is that in Europe, nobody was searching for the culprit. But in India, something of our political. And if you look at Delhi and Kerala, you may find that despite the fact they are not BJP ruled state, Tablighi Jamaat figured as a prominent entity, even in Kerala and West Bengal. So therefore, we have to address that question that the dominant imagination of COVID was that we have to have someone who can be blamed to. So this search for the culprit was something that is was central to the entire discourse on COVID. That's the first point which I would like to make. Zarqa has asked the second question, which is about the atheist thing, and I assume, in fact, I wrote that they must be from CPM because they must be more left, so it was understandable. So I don't think that I have to make any comment on that. But also, interesting question. I would like you to develop it. Why regional languages are completely missing in the popular stereotypical linguistic discourse?
Your voice is breaking. You're not audible at all.
You're not audible. Your voice is breaking.
Okay, let me reconnect. I think there's some problem. Let me reconnect again. Hello, can you hear me?
Yes, yes.
So the second point is about why the language of Hindutva or stereotypical, don't call it Hindutva, call it stereotypical anti-Muslim discourses, why they are not in the regional languages. I think you have to say something more on that. What I can imagine at the moment, there are three or four possibilities. One is that Hindutva is a North-centric phenomenon. Though you may find, the contemporary Hindutva should not be, always linked to Savarkar or Golwarkar. And this is what Mohan Bhagwat said. So it's a very different phenomenon. It's constituted in the name of one language, one culture, etc. And therefore, it was possible to spread it in either Hindi or English, Hindi and English. The real manifestation is something which can answer this. So that's the one possibility. The second possibility is that it underlies Hindutva homogeneity. So therefore, it is obvious. Can you hear me now?
Yes, yes.
Yeah. So it is obvious that in order to homogenize something, you have to have, sorry?
Can you just switch off your video? That often helps for the better voice, actually.
Okay.
Yeah, now.
Yeah. So the second possibility is that the adherence of Hindutva to produce a homogeneous Hindu community is something can be the second possibility why regionalism or regional languages are missing. And third is the spread of the reliability of Hindutva on popular culture. So Kangana Ranaut phenomena or the Bollywood is something which is very central to spread the message. So therefore, the regionalism, which may be very different, may evoke very different trajectory, can be interpreted or can be juxtaposed with the ways in which things are coming to us. So, but that's a very crucial question, remember. Hindi English, why the dominance of Hindi English in the stereotypical languages? Your question to caste, I think it's an important question, and it reminds us that we should not look at Muslim heterogeneity from the perspective of Hindu caste structure. When we say Muslim heterogeneity, we need to rely on different forms of social stratification. So therefore, when we say caste, instead of caste, we must have some kind of understanding of region-based stratification. So if we rely on region-based stratification, and by the way, your sample was very, very small, so you may get very different kind of responses. But if your sample is vast, then it is a, you know, then there is a possibility to evolve social stratification of different kind and use that method to find the differences and variety of Muslim community there. We have developed that in CSDS. So if you want to, you can have, we can have some discussion on that. Now, your point about women being more critical or more scientific is obviously well taken, because in our survey as well, we find that women's responses are more critical and more what we call more scientific in a general sense of the term. So therefore, you are well, I really like that point. But if I read that, if I, you know, compare your finding with other two findings, the major point which is coming out of the entire project, or at least these three presentations, is that the reconfiguration of religiosity in the wake of Corona. And this reconfiguration of contemporary Islamic religiosities is something which we must unpack, and we must try to theoretically explicate. In my view, there are three or four things which are emerging, which are not commonsensical, which are coming from the data which all three presentations made to us. First is that there is an idea, the criticism of Tablighi Jamaat shows that there is an inclination, and by the way, this reconfiguration of religiosity point might answer your last question, which is a very important question, were these responses were honest, or should we rely on them? Can we think of can we think of a political correctness out of it, or they were forced to answer the way it is posed to them? I'll come to this point later, but what is the reconfigured religiosity at the moment which is coming out from these three cases? First is that the criticism of Tablighi Jamaat, in my view, shows that there is an inclination to evoke self-criticism as a mode to evolve or make a distinction between the message and practice. Remember, this is something which is very specific to Islamic religious discourses since early 20th century. Iqbal was a prominent philosopher of that. Because Iqbal said, there are two very famous poems by Iqbal, and his book, Reconstitution of Religious Thought in Islam, all these point towards that you have to make a distinction between ritualistic aspect of religion and the philosophical aspect of religion. So when he makes a complaint to the God in his poem called Shikwa, he answers voters back with Jawab-e-Shikwa in a different way. So that's a component which is central to the Islamic philosophical discourses. And that is coming out now in a new fashion, when the criticism of Tablighi Jamaat is made at the same time evoking the religious text. So see, the criticism is not made from other bases. Rather, the centrality of religious text is invoked and used as a kind of resource to develop some kind of a criticism. So that's a evocation of the pure Islam in a different way to respond to the ritualistic aspect of religion. I think that's the major point which is emerging from these three cases study, specifically in your case, West Bengal. The second point which I can see emerging is that a new, how to represent a positive Muslim collectively. Earlier it was, it has always been, but this is what I said to the previous presentation, that now there is an inclination to accept the fact that communalism is not something which function at the political level. It has, it has entered into the social sphere. And therefore, it is very important to adjust with some kind of, while facing some kind of stereotypical imagination about the Muslim community, as one homogeneous entity. So therefore, how to reconfigure religiosity in order to produce a positive picture of Islam. That's the second thing which is emerging. The third possible and important point is that, and this is what I said to Sadia for the first presentation, and this is also important, that techno-savvy imagination of religiosity. COVID has somehow legitimized the use of moving images as part of dominant Islamic religiosity. And remember that, Muslims are using images, WhatsApp images, as well as videos, to underline that. By the way, because the project has already highlighted the social media discourse, I would ask you to not merely look at the anti-Muslim discourse narrative, but also look at the internal Muslim world and the WhatsApp groups or the social media posts which were there in the public discourses, and which have very different kind of responses to that. So therefore, all the answers which you provided, I think, may find some kind of a different frame. Now, the final point is about the honest responses. And this is what I said in the beginning. Survey questions are not answers. These are questions. And therefore, you are absolutely right when you question the question. You are right in relying that you are not going to rely on that. And therefore, you are converting the findings into a concept. And if you convert into a concept, then there is a possibility theoretically to press the concept and look at the ways in which this concept takes you to. So the honesty point is a crucial vantage point for us to go back and revisit the question which we have asked. And therefore, one of the findings would be that it makes a collective consciousness. Despite political correct, despite highly diversified universe of Muslim social, political, and religious imaginations, there is a collective consciousness emerging. And this collective consciousness is coming through the media, which constitute Hindu and Muslim as one homogeneous entity. So at the level of society, we may find diversity at work. But at the level of discourse, we may also find some kind of a collective consciousness emerging. So that's dialect. Islamic identities are like a pendulum, remember. These are a pendulum. So one extreme end is diversity. And the other extreme end is not diversity. The ideal type of Islam. So from ritual to ideal type of Islam, it moves like that. And at this moment, our task as a researcher is to capture the very point where it is at the moment. So this is what I actually find great in your paper. Thank you very much, but it's a wonderful paper, by the way.
Thank you so much. I just have one small point to make about the whole thing you said about the why the regional importance is not given, like the region. So it's been given in the paper, and I just rushed through the presentation, that's why, but I will keep in mind and I will work more on that. Other points very well taken. Thank you so much, and I have to leave. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you, Dr. Ahmed. And as I have already said to all the participants, that the objective of this presentation was primarily not to present what our researchers think of the responses, rather they have to present to the participants the data that they have, so that they get enough feedback to really conceptualize what they think are important. Your feedbacks have been of immense value. I think we will be able to actually formulate particularly the Uttar Pradesh and Kashmir paper, based on more data. And maybe in the West Bengal paper, it will be more like researchers' opinion beyond the data. But we will try to, when we decide on our final report, we'll try to include data-based analysis. And of course, you have not mentioned, but I would like to mention to participants that particularly from Kashmir and West Bengal, if we look at the sample which has been covered, actually belongs to a certain group. Like in Kashmir, the number of students is, or the percentage of students is just too much. And in West Bengal, the percentage of people who are educated, urban, is just too much, which also creates a limitation for us to call these as regional responses. So if possible, the researchers will go back to field to cover more areas and more groups. Otherwise, we will, when we submit the final report, we will specifically mention the group about which we are talking. Thanks a lot for agreeing to be here. Now I'll request Professor Masahiko Togawa to put forward his comments and also thank the participants. Masahiko Togawa, Professor Masahiko Togawa, as I have already introduced you, his university is sponsoring this project, and he is in charge of the whole project on Muslim identities in South Asia. Dr. Togawa.
Okay, thank you very much. Thank you very much all for all the very, very interesting and fascinating presentation. And I really enjoy today's presentation. And I think Ronjon and many other scholars from Bangladesh side, if there is someone, they can make some comment already. We will make feedback later on. So very interesting papers, and we learn many things, particularly the Indian situation. COVID number is very high. Now 6,685,000. That is very soon the taking overtake the America and become number one. So many Japanese people also concerned about the situation, and particularly today's topics, the issue of the communalization of the COVID situation. So centering the Tabligh Jamaat issue, that is very so serious things and very important things, but still we know very little about from Japanese side. So this today's seminar is very important to understand the situation, not only the present COVID situation, but also the historical context of the COVID in the background of the Muslim society among the India. Particularly, I am very impressed by the present situation discussed with the background of the historical background in case of the Kashmir issue. I understand the last year, August 2019, the situation, the central government taking over the state sovereignty, that is the very important background to understand the present situation that is presented Sadia. And Uttar Pradesh also, I didn't know that is the most serious, the religious conflicted state in India. That is very important background to understand the COVID situation, particularly the conspiracy theory. Both the Indian side, majority society having the Islamophobia after the case of the Tabligh Jamaat, but also the against the central government, that is a punishment by Allah, or some this kind of development is very we need to concern about the situation afterwards. And also the serving the West Bengal case, that is more familiar with me because I'm working on mainly on Bengali society, that So it is also very interesting to see discuss about the background of Hong Kong and the partition and also liberation war 1971. So this is also, I think, interesting to compare with the situation in Bangladesh. So the number of the COVID is first quickly increased in Bangladesh, but now maintains, not quickly increase, but they try to combine the economic activity as well as protection for the COVID in Bangladesh. But Indian situation is day by day increasing. That is very serious and we concern. But there is very different background because of the number of the tests and the medical treatment is different in both contexts. So maybe it is also interesting to compare comparative studies. Anyway, and now the time is already a lot of time has passed. So thank you very much for everybody. So thank you very much, interesting paper, Sadia, Zarkura, and Sarmin. And also thank you very much for Hilal Ahmed, your very wonderful chairpersonship and very significant comments, and it is very suggestive and very important to improve the each paper to further publication. And also thank you very much, Amitabh, for your all kind of effort to organize this wonderful seminar to realize. Thank you very much for all.
Thank you, everyone. Thank you, Dr. Ahmed. So now I am closing the meeting. Thanks a lot.